Good evening. If you'd like to come in and stand over here, make room for everybody. We're sorry there's not enough seats. We don't usually get this well attended, so something good happened tonight, I think, or bad, whatever your perspective is. If you haven't already, please sign in at the door there. When you walk in the door there, it's on the right. It being 7 o'clock or later, we're going to call the meeting to order with the first order of business, RDA 2015-2227 Blueberry Lane, Caganiello. Did I pronounce that right? Please correct me if I didn't. Somebody here for that hearing?
Blueberry Lane?
Okay, we'll discuss it then. All right, well.
If you can table it till the end of the next one.
We can do that. It. We can do that. Yeah, let's wait and see. Okay, we'll table that one till after the next hearing, which I assume is what everybody's here for. Okay.
You have to wait.
I have to wait 5 minutes.
We have some old business we can get out of the way.
Yep. We want to take the quick item on the list, the bond release.
Yeah, we have a bond from Cumberland Farms, 303 Salem Street. They got their certificate of compliance and recorded it at the Registry of Deeds. They requested that the bond be released. We need the commission to approve that.
Could you speak up, please?
Yes, I will.
How much is the bond for, just out of curiosity?
The bond's for $20,000.
I move we release the bond to Cumberland Farms since they've completed the western wetland restoration at their site on what street is it?
It's 303 Salem Street.
Salem Street.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Any other quick items we can do?
Yes, you can approve the certificate of the
O'Sullivan 31 Curtis Street.
Yeah, 31 okay. Curtis Street.
COC 270-0616 31 Curtis Street, O'Sullivan.
This is part of the site walk.
We did do a site visit. It was myself and Rebecca and Mr. Coulliard. I apologize for not distributing those notes at this point. I can get them out to you. The backyard was all hydroseeded. The front yard had rolled out grass.
Sod.
And we didn't see the resource area, and then we quickly pieced together that it was behind the fence at the end of the yard. Things look complete. There's no grass established in the backyard yet. And there's really minimal vegetation in front of that fence. So we saw what was there now. I guess one question that I had after the site visit was, were there any plantings that were supposed to be there that were part of the order of conditions? Maybe you can answer
inside
that.
Inside the fence?
Within, 15, 20 feet of the fence.
If some of you could move to this wall, I think it would help a lot of people to get in if you don't mind.
Was there a marker?
I did not find a wetland marker.
Right.
I didn't find a buffer marker.
Karen sent me pictures of the markers.
I did see a metal stake. Maybe that's...
No, he came in for the markers, and
okay.
He sent me pictures of the markers. He put them on the fence, and
okay.
I think the metal stake is in the ground. So.
What kind of fence is it, Amika?
It's a high stockade fence.
See through it.
It's a pretty good barrier to that wetlands. I think if there weren't any plantings, we should just go ahead and approve it.
Yeah, it looks stable. I mean, if the grass establishes, I don't know how much growing we're going to get.
You're not going to get much growing right now.
So what's going to happen to that seed? Is it just going to be dormant until spring and then take over?
Yeah, there's a little bit of peach fuzz there. I think that'll come in the spring.
Or maybe in the next couple of weeks it's been pretty warm.
Well,
it's going to be in the 60s.
Anything on the
Were there any?
It doesn't show any vegetation there. I have to read through the order to find out if we requested any. Is that what you're asking, or was
I'm
there
just
there
wondering
in the
if there
place?
Was some additional plantings along that fence. I saw those two pine trees that I can see on the plan.
Mm-hmm.
It was existing lawn, is that correct, if I remember correctly?
Yes.
Well, then it probably is returned to lawn, so.
What's the feeling of the commission? Do you want to approve it, just approve it, or?
Well, is Chuck looking
Chuck's
to
got
see?
The order of conditions right here.
Oh, he does.
He's
okay.
Just scanning through.
From what I can see, this quick scan does not, we did not ask for any vegetation or plantings.
Okay, I'm fine with that.
All right. Do we have a motion to issue a certificate of compliance for 31 Curtis Street?
So moved.
Second?
I'll second.
All those in favor? Okay. Before I move on, Chuck, is there a number for, do we have the DEP number yet?
26 Harvard Street, yes, there is a DEP number. Oh,
652. Okay. Okay. You ready?
I have 711.
All right. It being 7:10 or later, I'm going to open the hearing for ANRAD 270-0652, 25 Springvale Road and Randall Road, Map 10, Lot 294 and 296, Map 15, Lots 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. Public hearing for ANRAD 270-0652. Is now opened and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetland Protection Act, Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. The hearing will be conducted in the following manner. The applicant will present the proposal. The commission will receive reports from its administrator, technical advisors, and other town departments. The commission will address questions and comments to the applicant. The public will then be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be directed to the chair. Please give your name and address before your comments and or questions are presented. If you haven't done so already, please sign at the attendance sheet at the by the door there. At this time, would the members of the Conservation Commission please introduce themselves, starting with Chuck?
Chuck Tarone, Conservation Administrator.
Michael Flynn.
Anika Scanlon.
Brian Sullivan, Chair. Al Couliard.
Jamie Mohan.
Rebecca Longley, Vice Chair.
Judy Roger, Recording Secretary.
Okay.
Is there a representative?
Is there a representative?
I am Stephen Erickson from North Environmental Services.
Yes, you have the floor.
We were out there Monday. Went over some changes on the flags, a couple of the flags. We didn't quite arrive at a consensus on the entire site yet. So the commission members had discussed the possibility of going to an outside consultant,
and we don't really have a problem with that.
Okay.
Since I was unable to attend the site visit, could you explain to us the nature of the different opinions as to where wetlands were or were not, and what some of the supporting evidence was?
We have one small bowl that has some hydric soil at the bottom of it. We have to find the extent of that, find out if it's larger than the 500 square feet mentioned in the bylaw. And a couple of the flags, we just moved a few feet because we had a minor disagreement on the soils. What you would expect, the definition of a hydric soil is water at or near the surface for a significant portion of the year. At or near the surface is 12 inches. Significant portion of the year is only 10 days during the growing season. So if I got a water table at 13 inches, it's not a wetland. If I got it at 11 inches, it is a wetland. It's easy to see how there would be minor differences of opinion So we moved a few flags. Not a problem to us.
So is there agreement on, after making those minor adjustments to the flags, is there agreement on wetland line A and B?
There's agreement on most of it, but we did move two of the flags. I haven't gotten the surveyor out there to revise the plan at this time.
But I mean, are you in agreement with the way the commission moved the flags?
Yes.
For A and B? So the only area where there's a question is this depression?
Pretty much, yes.
We had a site visit on Sunday, and we also, Anika, Al, myself, on Sunday, and then we also attended on Monday afternoon with Mr. Erickson and Maureen, I don't know Maureen's last name, from Norse Environmental. We also saw, after you left, we were walking straight back from the Randall Street, Randall Road cul-de-sac, and it appeared as though that area was pretty low. And we couldn't really tell what the vegetation was, but we didn't take any cores in that area. But that would be a little bit of a question, I think, as well.
I know the area you're talking about.
I'm sorry?
I know the area that you're talking about.
Okay, all right.
I actually did a lot of soil probes in that area to be sure that
okay.
Originally I had flagged that as a wetland, and when I verified the soils, I found that it was not a wetland, oddly enough.
What time of year did you do the flagging?
It was probably 3 months ago.
So there was full leaf vegetation when you were at
Oh, yes.
So it seemed like for Mike and Brian, who weren't on either of the site walks, it seemed like most of us who were there were in agreement that this project should go to peer review.
Mm-hmm.
And the questions really were surrounding how we were going to accomplish that. So I think Chuck should maybe go through the process of how we'd go through peer review.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I guess, Jamie, just to finish off, there was a line established, and I think there could have been other lines, not moving that line, but another wetland, so you might have another line.
A C line.
Yeah, out in that field somewhere, and maybe a D also. So,
sure.
To move the flag up.
Sorry, what area? Just because
So I think this the C line might be in the center of the property, but to the left of the Randall Road extension.
Like parcel between parcel 6 and 7.
Between 6 and 7, which is along that line.
Yeah, down in that area, and it almost. So the slope of the site slopes from right to left and front to back. So it kind of, right off that Randall Road extension, there's a pocket, and then there's some fill, because it has historic fill on the site too, and there's a channel, and then it gets down into where that stream is. But the when they dug the stream out, there's a berm. So there's a lot of different areas where this water can get hung up, and it's not a direct shot. So that would be my guess where a C line might be, or at least an area to check out. And then the D would probably be to the left, to the right of the cul-de-sac as you walk in and see where that is.
It was, my general comments about the terrain back there was very, very hummocky. When you get it, when you first enter
could
in.
Could you speak up? We can't
we
hear you.
We really can't
sure.
hear anybody.
Sure.
Do those
yeah.
mics work?
Yeah, we don't hear anybody.
Those
I don't,
mics only
these,
go to the cable TV.
Yeah,
sorry.
These That's aren't right. for public.
You have to tune
so
in.
You could go home and watch it on TV and hear as clear as a bell.
Could you repeat what you just said, please?
We think you folks can hear each other, but the peanut gallery here, really, yeah. we're pretty
no,
deaf.
That's I don't mind repeating. That's fine.
Thank you.
Just as a, can you hear me?
Yeah, all right.
As a general comment for the site visits, my impression was that terrain back there had a lot of small hummocks, and you know the topography was very irregular. I think the farther you got, the deeper you got down that paper road, the less hummocky and more predictable the slope was. But generally speaking, the slope was, as you're walking down Randall Road, the slope was this way, down in this direction. So the high point
to
would
the
have
east.
Been to the north. To the north. To the north, kind of north northeast, generally speaking, but within 40 feet of that cul-de-sac, it was very hummocky. It was going every which way.
Anika, do you think those hummocks were the result of filling or just natural topography?
No, I think it was historic past practices, and the trees there, we were guessing some of the trees ranged in age that were growing in that fill, from young saplings to 50 plus years old. Was that the general consensus, or some of the older ones were significantly round?
Were these areas C and D, for lack of a better term, hydraulically connected to the stream?
No, this whole terrain, including the wetland that is immediately north of that cul-de-sac dash line, that is perched, is well perched.
The beeline.
Okay, so the if help
is
me
the
ask
beeline. Is 3 to 4 feet above the stream.
Help me out, Chuck, but if they're isolated, they're wetlands under the bylaw, but not under the state definition.
Right,
so 500,
right.
500 square feet.
Mm-hmm.
And they may not be connected because of that fill. So.
So it sounds to me that we need not only look at those isolated areas in terms of soil and perhaps vegetation, we probably need some elevation surveys too, at like 1-2 foot intervals.
I think. But
is that the consensus of the people that were at the site?
I think that would help.
I think that would help for us to look at this project and have a better understanding of where those lower elevation areas are on across the site. Yeah, that's something I asked during one of the site visits.
You don't have any existing 2 foot.
I don't, and I'm not sure how much the topography would show. If we're in 2 foot contours, there are a lot of things that would not show.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So, and typically we don't do 1 foot contours because it's a lot more work to survey it like that. Mm-hmm. But I have no problem doing the survey because we'd like to do it before the snow flies anyway.
Now, did you investigate the areas that they're talking about? You must have.
No, I know what areas they're talking about. A lot of the sites have been disturbed.
Yeah.
So it's you get disturbed areas, there are all kinds of things that could have happened in the past.
Mm-hmm.
The disturbance was many years ago, but nevertheless, a lot of the site is disturbed.
Mm-hmm.
For those of you on site, was there any remaining evidence of wetland vegetation, or are we too late in the season?
You can still see the cinnamon fern, sensitive fern, and a bunch of the growth on the ground. You've got the trees and the shrubs naturally. They don't disappear at all. And they're not all that difficult to identify.
So these areas, did they have these obligatory wetland
plans? We did ask where the data plots were coming from while we were out on site. I asked on the phone once and I asked on the site, and we were never, it seems like that they weren't marked and we didn't got into something else. So I was interested in, so we have an obligate on one of them, or at least we have a pine on one and on one sheet, and then a pine on the other sheet also. And I was really interested in where these pine trees were for myself, so I did want to know where those plots were taken.
If we do get a third party wetland consultant to do a delineation, do we have to wait till spring, or is it going to be based primarily on soils? Because even if it's primarily on soils, by the time we get them on board, ground could be frozen, snow could be.
I think the areas that we're concerned about are going to be determined primarily by soils. And we don't get a deep freeze until sometime in January. Most years, we're flagging wetlands all through the winter, except for last year in February when it was virtually impossible.
And my guess, I didn't want to interrupt Chuck's explanation of the third party, but it would take us at least a month to get one under contract and out there in the field, at least a month. And since we're not meeting again this month, it might be more like a month and a half.
It's not going to snow this year.
Oh, good.
We had enough last year.
Or freeze. Well, I did make some phone calls to see who was available. And there are a few people could jump right on this. Obviously, once we've secured a consultant and pick up a check and determine what the scope of work is, then we could get a price. Well, there's already an account set up. At least I believe there's already a revolving account set up. I checked into that today. So outside of that, you might be able to get an answer for the first meeting in January or at least the second meeting in January.
Did you check on, it's been a long time since we've done this, did you check on the TAN procurement, how the TAN procurement regulations apply to this?
We had limited people in town hall today and I ran into that problem a couple of times, but reviewing, there is a revolving fund that has a consultant fee title to it.
Right. I know we have the money. Yeah. How many bids do we have to get? They have to be sealed and yada, yada, yada.
Well, probably under 5,000.
Yeah, under
okay.
A certain amount, you don't.
Okay.
Probably be a
3,000. The amount allows the commission to hire an outside consultant.
Right, right.
If you just authorize Chuck to hire one of the people on the list, we'll bring down a check and we can be out there next week.
Yeah, I don't think we can do that.
Why?
When we've done it before, we've gotten multiple bids. We've gotten the concurrence of the applicant because everyone's going to have to pay the fee before we hire them on. I'd feel more comfortable doing that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you've got three different people and they all offer a bid and give us the opportunity to choose one, and it's a done deal, we'll bring a check in and...
Right. Yeah, I don't want to be an obstacle. I just want to make sure that we don't violate procurement laws.
So look into that, Chuck. We're going to look into that when you're able to.
The town manager was just here. We should have grabbed him while he was here.
The understanding is you don't run into the procurement problems until it's over $5,000.
I'm not sure.
Depends on
right,
local law.
I
depends
can't
on the bylaw.
This being a $5,000 job, we're talking about half a day's work, if that.
What's the scope of work the commission wants to bid on?
What? I mean, do we want to do the whole site or just these areas? If we're already in concurrence on those lines A and B, then it doesn't make much sense to resurvey those. If we're concurrence, there are only two areas under question, we could limit the scope to those two areas.
I think that...
Having not been out there, I apologize. I'm not the one to...
So where those lines are put anyways are probably not correct. It's just at the exact top of the bag. It's not 18 inches up off the base or, natural occurring water or anything like that. So those could move also.
I'm sorry, Chuck. So you're talking about the A and B line right
now. Yeah. Well, at least the A line.
I would like to see the whole existing line verified.
I mean, if it's peer reviewed, that's...
I mean, if the commissioners question those lines, I would agree. I thought there was concurrence,
rather than have them come back, the whole thing should be reviewed. That's my opinion.
I agree.
I agree, too.
I concur.
Okay.
We only had agreement, really, from the start of the A series up in here. Once we got to A6, there was some question. So it's not much that we concurred with.
And a question we struggle with when we do this, do we move those flags and get him to go out with a blank sheet of paper and delineate the wetlands, or do we ask him to verify that line and make suggested modifications? the second would be easier and cheaper.
I think the second. I mean, yeah, I don't think there's any need to do that.
There's other flags out there from other delineations that never were brought to the Conservation Commission. So there's a lot of information out there.
And these flags are surveyed in. We have GPS locations for these flags.
The old flags?
No.
The ones that are right there now. Your A and B lines.
Our A and B line is surveyed in.
Okay. Yeah. So do we want this peer reviewer to survey those in, or do we want Norris Environmental to come back and survey the new lines? That's the type of thing we need in the scope.
Typically, we would go out with the consultant, review the line right there at the same time, and if the changes are reasonable, we just change them.
And resurvey?
Resurvey, yeah.
Yeah. If we don't resurvey, we'll just, if we move a flag, we'll move this flag 5 feet, this flag 10 feet, whatever it happens to be. But we reach an agreement on site, typically.
Who's doing the new survey, or the consultant?
I mean, that's the question.
Yeah.
I mean, it sounds like Norris is going to be out there with them. There's no reason to have this consultant to do the survey.
Okay.
As long as they're coming to agreement.
I wouldn't disagree.
As long as the consultant is amenable to the changes that are made on the plan and checks the plan, I think it makes sense. I mean, for Norris to resurvey and prepare a new plan. They've got all the information.
Mm-hmm. So Norris is going to do an elevation survey and then resurvey the new wetland flags and provide a plan to the commission.
Just for full disclosure, I am a soil scientist, botanist, and wetland scientist, not a surveyor. JM Associates will be doing the survey.
Okay.
I've got people qualified at it doing it, not me.
Okay.
So what's in the action? That's it for the scope of services?
That's all you have. You just want them to review the resource areas on the site.
Well, and we want them to look and check those low-lying areas that possibly could be wet and maintain 500 square feet.
Do we want to add an hour or two for a meeting, for attending a meeting?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
That would help.
Mm-hmm.
So if they do determine that those low-lying areas are wetlands, they'd have to flag them, then the surveyor would have to calculate the area.
Yes.
That would be normal operating procedure.
Okay.
I would also like to see some DEP data sheets and the locations of those data points on the plan.
That's deliverable from the consultant.
Right.
The third party.
Yep.
So, Chuck, if you could draft that scope and send it out to...
I'm just going to go over a few things from my memory on these. Sometimes they go out together, sometimes the third party goes out by himself, then has a meeting on site with the other party. They come to a meeting and talk about what they found, and they usually also put in the bid a second meeting if needed. So
I would definitely have that.
Wise.
Definitely.
And I think Norris or the applicant is offered to be out there when they're out there the first time, so I think that makes the most sense.
And from what I'm saying is they're just data sheets and data points. We're going to have JM survey, resurvey a plan with elevations on it.
If you could draft that and send it out to the commissioners, and at the same time you send it out to the people on your list. And then if they could be back in bids at our next meeting, which is January something.
I think it's
I don't know. I'm not sure if can Chuck do that without coming back to the next meeting.
I mean, my opinion is I'd like to see him, but it's the commission's decision.
And I think as long as it's under $5,000. I think it's something Chuck can accomplish, and maybe get this done.
Who is he going to select?
He's provided us the list.
I know, but is he going to select just the lowest price? I'm not terribly comfortable with that.
No.
I don't know.
Well, it's the lowest price is not really where you want to be. You want to be the lowest price and the person that you think is qualified to do the work.
I agree. But, yeah. And I think I personally would feel better if the commissioner made that decision, just the commission made that decision rather than just the administrator.
Maybe we could have a quick meeting to choose.
Yes. I think there's good enough reason to have a quick meeting within the next couple of weeks once we get the bids to make that selection.
And if I can, let's ask these applicants to also attach their resume.
Yeah,
qualifications.
Yeah,
pretty much.
Their quals.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
So that we can have a baseline, mm-hmm. and all be on the same page in terms of what their experience and
I think Chuck has a list right now.
This list right here, I'm familiar with every.
I didn't get a chance to pass it out to everyone.
Oh, I thought you all had this information.
I passed it.
I have a list, but I'm not familiar.
I passed it on.
All
that's the one that Brian.
You want to pass that down?
No, I get it.
I don't know if they have it.
I understand, but I still have
this.
Not seen.
Andy,
can
you need that bottom page? Let me have that bottom page back.
Sure. This one?
Yeah. Andy, we'll come back later.
We're all set.
You got them?
Okay.
So if you want to add to this list, I'll make phone calls, but I'm going, this is a list I'm going to call.
If the commission is in agreement with all of the people on this list, I don't know why we couldn't just let Chuck go ahead and pick one. We'd like some input, of course, but I don't mind Mr. Prokof. I don't have a problem with Jillian Davies. I don't mind Mr. Rockwell.
It should be the commission's decision, not the applicant's decision.
Yeah, and I think we want to, you know, there's several commissioners here that are familiar with some of these firms or some of the people, but there's other commissioners that aren't. I think they would like the opportunity to see the bids, to see the qualifications from at least a few of these. So I don't know that we need to reach out to all five or additional, but.
All five aren't going to be available.
Yeah.
Right.
So I'm going to call those five. So do you want me to go with this, or you have someone else to add?
I think
it's fine. Yeah. Okay.
I just want to add that in terms of the timing of this, I know that it's challenging getting all our schedules to coordinate, but we have had additional meetings on as a practice. If we have had an additional meeting that has one agenda item, and this could be one of those situations where we put out one agenda for like the first week of January that is simply choose, you know, selection, discussion of who's going to be the hired the wetland specialist
third
for this
party.
Project. Thank you.
Okay. When is our next scheduled meeting?
Did you look? Is it the 9th? I can look at 2nd.
13th or
13th, I think it would be, was what I saw.
Okay, so we could meet maybe
the 13th, yeah.
The 6th, or is next week too soon?
Let's make sure we've. I mean, we should try to figure this out quickly, but let's make sure we've got bids in hand before
mm-hmm.
we.
Right, we need.
You need at least 3 bids, right?
Right,
right, and so we need at least a week's notice for our meeting, right?
Yeah.
So yeah.
It's usually, I can post a meeting as late as Monday for a Wednesday meeting.
Oh, okay.
Monday before 4.
Okay, today's.
So do you have any objection to adding Hughes to the list if you have any issues, you know, with timing?
I do.
You do?
Yeah.
What's that? What's the issue?
He's not a wetland scientist. These guys are all wetland scientists.
All right.
Except for Rick Kirby, but I think someone at his firm does, in LEC Environmental. But I've worked with Rich before, but if he's not a professional wetland scientist, I wasn't going to put him on this site. I just think it's tough. I mean, it's a tough site. The rest of the people have
Hughes
huge qualifications.
Hughes is a soil scientist, is that correct?
Rick? Rich Kirby?
Hughes.
He's not. He's a consultant. I don't know what I've seen his background before.
I think he's a soil scientist. I'm
I don't know.
Sure.
I know he's not. I think he's like an English major. I really do. He put in his application at another place, and I was reading it. So
I know he's done an excellent
so
job.
Well,
he does. He does a really good job. But this is not the site for him.
Okay.
I know Prokof, Brian Butler, John Buckwood, and Julian Davies are all soil scientists.
Yep.
Okay.
So we would schedule a meeting after you hear back from...
Well, they left a message, and I actually talked to Oxbow. I left a message with Jillian. I know that I can get a hold of Prokof. And then Rockwell, there's two people at that firm. It's Rockwell, or I don't know the other guy. Do you know the other person?
I've worked with him, but I don't know his
Yeah,
name.
There's two people at that firm, so there's... I think there's plenty of opportunity for someone to come up who could get three bids without a problem in a couple of weeks.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, where are we in a couple of weeks, though?
It's a small scope of services.
Yes. Yeah, so we're going to be the first. We're going to be the first week in January, anyways, with a special meeting, and it's only the 13th.
Oh,
only
you don't
one
think
we
do it the 23rd?
Well, if I got it's the 9th. If I gave 2 weeks to get something back,
the
that's
24th
Christmas
instead.
The next year is
we cannot the do the 23rd.
Well, maybe the 30th. We might be able to do the 30th, huh?
The week of...
Don't do that to me.
Oh, you're skiing. Okay, first week in January.
It's a matter of quorum.
That works.
Quorum, I mean...
Well, it's a quorum issue. I mean, I'll just put it out there. I'll ask them for the bids before the 28th if they can't do it. We'll see what everyone says. Then it'll be the 4th. But let them lead it.
If we can see the bids ahead of time and we have the
oh yeah there. And send us the scope when you send it to them if you would please.
Well yeah, I'm gonna send the scope out and maybe there's something you want to add before I send it to them.
That would be even better.
Yeah.
Okay.
Can I see that list coming?
Is the commission through with comments and questions?
I guess I move that we solicit bids from the 5 wetland consultants on the circulated list to do evaluation of the wetlands at on Randall Road.
Okay, is there
I'll
a second?
That.
All those in favor? Okay, so we'll just explain to these people what we did. So people don't have any comments.
Explain to us what we did.
Okay, so for those of you who weren't able to follow along, basically what we did was we have agreed and we have voted to hire an outside consultant to review the materials submitted for the wetland delineation and the resource delineation at this site. The once we've determined at that the next meeting that we're going to have, which will probably be a special meeting before our next meeting, who's going to be the consultant, they will review the work that's already been done and provide us with their professional recommendations and either, as we were discussing, change the lines as appropriate in the field. They will then come to that meeting, to the next regular meeting, which is going to be January 13th, I think,
would be the meeting.
To report their findings.
Oh, that's right. We need to make sure in the scope that they have the work done by that 13th.
Either the 13th or
the following
meeting. Yeah. Whenever the work is done, they'll report their findings. and then we'll move forward from there. So, that being said, I will open the floor to the audience for any questions for the applicant or for the commission. Please state your name and address prior to speaking.
Stephen Donovan, 36 Randall Road. You said that's an independent survey that comes in, then why would they involve the company that's being paid by the people that want to bulldoze the woods? Should he not be involved at all?
Well, he's going to be on site to answer questions. He will not, this independent consultant will independently place the wetland flag, and just to make sure that you understand, it's not town money paying this independent consultant. The town will select that consultant, but he's being paid by the applicant.
Mm-hmm.
And
the
I
anticipate usually, sorry, but the consultant is a professional, and they've been in this situation a lot. So they're not going to be browbeaten into moving their flags. There may be a discussion, but that consultant works for us. And he's not going to have much contact with Norse Environmental, but they will, and I've seen it before, they do go to the site together. So so.
And I anticipate that at least one of the commissioners will be on site when this independent consultant is at. No guarantees based on when they're going to do it, but that's our general procedures, to have at least one, if not more, at on site.
Yes.
Debbie Hames, 25 Randall Road. Can we request that someone from the commission be on that survey?
Absolutely, you can request that.
Sure.
So we know that when it's happening, one of you guys are on there?
You can certainly request it. I don't think we can guarantee that we'll be there just based on our schedules. I don't know if somebody want to take, if the commission feels strongly, we can dictate that they have the site visit when one or more of us are available. But if they just do it at their date that they set, we can't guarantee we'll be there.
Well, let me just comment that, first of all, at least two of us during the week are generally available, and if not, for whatever reason, Chuck is available during office hours that are posted at Town Hall. So between Chuck and some of us, there's a very, very good chance that someone is probably going to be there.
I'm sorry, one more question. And this is Chuck?
That's
this
Chuck.
Is Mr. Tirone. Yes, our administrator.
Down, like, who is Chuck?
Yeah, this
I mean,
is our administrator.
We could write in the scope that they have to schedule the visit.
That makes a lot of sense.
I think it should
not
be coordinated
on a
with
Saturday
us.
Or
okay.
Sunday,
yes.
But otherwise, or Friday. Otherwise, it would be fine.
And we communicate, the commission communicates via email all the time, so it's generally not an issue to be able to have someone be in contact with the consultant.
Well, can we make sure that that's written in? That it's not going to be, it's going to be Monday through Thursday, and one of the counselors and him.
Well, it could be on a weekend, because our normal site visits are on a weekend, and the commissioner could be there. I mean, if the commissioner wants to make
He works Monday through Thursday, that's what I'm saying.
Well, I know, but the commissioners work on weekends. So,
yeah, so
I mean, if somebody wants to make a motion that the site visit has to be
coordinated with
has
the commission
to be approved
number,
by the commission
yeah.
based on one or more being there, we could do that.
You want
anybody
want to
make that motion?
There.
Well, he can put it in the scope.
Okay.
And then you're writing it into the scope. Is that correct that you're going to send around to us?
Yeah.
Okay.
I have no objection to that.
Yeah, I don't have an objection to that. Okay.
Is there any reason why? Oh, I'm Frank Coleman, 26 Randall Road. Sorry. Is there any reason why we can't get a complete reevaluation of this from an independent third party without Norse there? I think that's what all these questions are leading to, and I don't see why they have to be there.
Well, it's their site, so they have a right to be there. So.
Well, what if we?
I might feel like your site, but someone else bought it, and they have a right to be there, and they can be represented, and that's just how it works. It's just we're not going to make a special accommodation because
it's not our impression it's been sold.
Well, someone owns it.
Somebody owns it, right? And they have some time.
And they're allowing Norse to be on it.
So what we're saying is, will the owner allow a third party on who doesn't confer with Norse, who you pick, or we have some input in picking?
That's up to the commission. We can tell when they submit their application, they give us authorization to go on the site, either us or our agents. So we can send our independent consultant on that site at any time. But as Chuck said, the owner of the property has the right to be there. We cannot restrict that.
Okay, so we would need permission from the owner.
That's correct.
In other words, what you're saying is Norse has to be on the property as host to this other?
They don't have to
but they
have the right to be.
So can we find out if the owner insists on that or not?
That's outside of the jurisdiction of this commission.
But we would like total impartiality here. Total.
That's what you're going to get.
That's what you're going to get. That's why we're hiring a third party. why we're going to be on site.
Do we have any say in who the third party is?
Only you certainly can express your opinion in a public meeting, and when we meet again to discuss these, you're welcome and can express an opinion, but it's up to the commission to vote on that.
The reason I bring this up, and I'll just, somebody who I will not name who is an expert in this, I've discussed this at length with this person, and his or her opinion is much different than the results that Norse came up with. So we want, you know, a clean slate, another impartial look at this as much as possible, okay?
If that person is a certified, qualified wetland scientist and you want to submit that name to Chuck, we'd consider offering them to make a bid.
The person isn't for hire. This was not doing this anymore, but very, very well qualified. And I didn't think I'd see much difference between the town map online where the wetlands are and what Norse has come up with. And this is
there's big differences.
Huge.
There's big differences everywhere in Reading.
So my question was, could this change this fast? And
the line on the town map.
The town map's a very inaccurate.
Is taken from aerial photos. They're not on the ground.
How do we get a copy of the other map?
Pardon me?
How do we get privy to copies of the other map?
Right.
We have no knowledge of
you would have to have a wetland scientist create a map for you. That's what I'm saying. These town maps are approximations.
Yeah, they are.
So
which map are you talking about? The one that we have right now? Or the new one?
You're saying the town map is very different than what's really out there. So how do we get privy information to...
So the aerial photo is not surveyed in. So no one actually went to the site to do a delineation.
Yeah, that's what's listed on the town GIS mapping. All the town maps are based on aerial photographs.
So the town map 2012. The town map is guesswork?
No, not necessarily. It's
well,
GIS.
It's
GIS.
That's what I'm
well,
hearing.
It's not.
No, it is.
It's
not.
Right.
It's not to
guesswork.
It is guesswork. Okay.
It's
not
we
to
actually have a disclaimer on the site saying that these are not accurate. So read that disclaimer and you'll understand what you're looking at. On the town map. Those wetlands that are on there can be wrong, and they're not to be used for an application of this magnitude.
That's not entirely correct. They are accurate, but the resolution of that map is much greater than someone's lot. They use it by looking at aerial photography of vegetation. This is how they make GIS maps.
That part might be right.
So you can't take a GIS map that was made for the town of Reading and say, my lot's 10,000 square feet, and this shows that there's no wetlands on here, so it's correct. That's not the way it works. To look at the overall town of Reading, this is just how GIS works. If you need to verify your own lot, you have to have a wetland scientist go out there and refine those lines, and that's what happens. Sometimes we're further away, sometimes they're closer. And we see it everywhere in Reading, and this is a common misconception that people get in the town looking at those maps. So we had to put that disclaimer on. Subsequently, because people have the same reaction. They're just for informational purposes.
But can you show us graphically what the town... I've seen it on the town map on the website.
Mm-hmm.
And Chuck nicely put me onto that.
Mm-hmm.
But I haven't seen Norse's, except at a glance, which I see as like it's two different worlds.
Sure.
And
sure.
I thought maybe here somebody would explain that, why they're so different and how much they're different by... But is that not for this meeting?
Yeah.
They're different. The difference is around 100 feet.
That's a lot.
That they drove the wetland line back, but we've just explained that wetland line that you see on the town map, first off, is 2012. It's an aerial photo. It's not accurate. There's a disclaimer on that site. And this is the only gentleman that's been out there and put some boots on the ground and went through the work to find a line that this office has received a plan for. So what we need to do now that that's here is verify the line, and we're going through that process right now.
Okay.
So that doesn't mean it's correct. Mm-hmm. It means it needs to be verified. And once it is verified, then it's going to be good for the next 3 years.
Good explanation. Thank you.
So with respect to the question that this woman had here, these are public record now. Is that correct? Chuck?
The filing.
The filing is public record.
Filing is that when we send out the legal notice, we ask, it says right on it, come on in and you can look at the file and get copies.
So that's how you get a copy.
Perfect.
And that'll show you their wetland lines and you can have your own copy.
Hi, I'm Gina Willett, 40 Glenmere Circle. I was wondering, is it possible to determine the lines this time of year? I know that you're asking questions about when the original scan was taken. Is this something that should be waiting until the spring to determine correctly?
As I think we've heard tonight, these wetlands in question are going to be determined primarily by soil type. And the soils, as long as the granite isn't too frozen, we can make that determination. Wetlands are defined in the state of Massachusetts and in Reading specifically by three factors. One is vegetation, which we're limited. The second is soil type. We can tell from looking at the soil whether or not those soils are flooded or inundated or saturated for a good period of the year. And then the third type is the hydraulic connection to the stream. We can tell until the ground freezes, certainly the hydraulic connection, particularly with the survey, and the soil type. We can't tell the vegetation, but we think in this case soils will be the determining factor. Now the third party consultant could come back and say, I cannot make a definitive delineation until the spring. We don't expect that to happen, but it is a possibility.
Now to add to that, the soils change very slowly. So if this area is a wetland, then the soil, they won't change in one season. The soils don't change in a season. It takes many, many seasons of wetting and drying and wetting or staying wet for the soils to show the characteristics that determine it's a wetland. So it's not something that changes overnight.
Hi, Bill Fox, 35 Randall Road. In regards to the soil, would it be appropriate to be taking those tests if there was like a frost or a freeze or the soil was frozen? Would that make a difference?
A frost, no, but if we get freezing to 2 or 3 feet, that would be a problem. That's why we want to do it before February.
If there's a freeze, they're not going to be able to take the sample, so they just won't be able to. Okay. They use a hand auger to get into these grounds. I mean,
is it just like the saturation of the soil, or is it the actual soil type? Do you test to see what kind of soil
it's fairly complex, and I won't do a very good job of explaining it. But what happens when the water comes up into the soil? It basically leaves a trace. It leaves some marks. It oxidizes some of the metals in the soil, and you can examine and you can tell historically how high that water has come up into the soil.
Okay, one more question, or maybe two. It's kind of dry, or it has been kind of dry. I think we're kind of in a seasonably kind of dry spell. I mean, the summer was really dry. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't think we really got that much rain this fall. Would that be
as Brian said, the soils stay the same for a year.
Nope.
We're not looking at the water, we're looking at the chemical trace of where the water has been.
I gotcha.
It's like a water stain in your wall. If you had ice stains
exactly
last winter, my water stains are still on the wall.
Right.
It's kind of the
just
type thing we're
thing.
Looking at.
Mr. North said he was out there a few months ago to do his. There was also a crew out there in May. There was a crew out there in May doing readings and surveying, and my wife spoke with them, and they were from North. So we would just like to know what the results from that visit were.
And also from September 2014.
So there have been people in those woods before September or whatever he says. There's been people in and out of those woods for a long time now.
It wouldn't be unusual for the client to hire me to look at the property before he buys the property. So he knows what's going on. A lot of times, the builder will call me up and just say, why don't you go look at that lot? I don't know if it's worth the effort. If I look at the lot and the whole thing ends up being a wetland, then I just tell him, walk away. For the soils part, if I could explain, what's happening in the soil is, when it's under aerobic conditions, the iron in the soil is under, in the ferrous state. Think of it as rust. In the ferrous state, it's got oxygen in it. It leaves that nice brown color for the subsoil that we're looking at. When it becomes anaerobic, the bacteria and literally using the oxygen in the ferrous soil, and they're converting it into the ferric state. In the ferric state, the iron is soluble in the soil, so it either collects and we get concentrations of it, or it disappears and we get a gray color. That reaction happens in as little as 2 weeks, but once it happens, it never goes away.
Melody Fox, 35 Randall Road. I would like to know, that's totally understandable, but we're talking about areas that are dry, wet. It's questionable where, depending on where you take it. Do you actually, when you take the soil sample, do you mark the GPS area exactly where you take the soil sample so we all know where you're taking it? And you could.
I don't take a GPS. What I do is I take an auger, and after the auger down, we check the soil to 18 to 22 inches, and once we find the soil, we hang up a flag or put up a ribbon in that area. We then send the surveyor out. The surveyor locates those flags and puts it onto a plan.
Right. Okay. So since we're talking about a 100-foot difference in what is going on, obviously there's a reason why when Randall Road was built that Mr. Angelini stopped where he did, because there was supposed to be a paper road that went out. So there's a reason, and instead of just taking certain areas, you know, I think there needs to be, like you said, a bigger area of investigation as opposed to taking certain soil samples, and because there's definitely a very large discrepancy. And I did want to ask about, you guys, you were talking about the certain lines in question, and I don't understand any of that. So on a map, could someone possibly tell me exactly which areas were in question in this area? I mean, out of curiosity.
We have Luda.
I don't know when they did Randall Road. I don't know how long ago it was.
Yeah, I think it's worth showing where the lines are currently. So one thing I will add is one of the things the commission brought up when we're talking about the scope of work from the peer review is that we asked for logs from whoever we hire. And what they're going to provide to us when they go out there is, as they take a soil sample, they're going to sit there and say, yes, you know, we found something, no, we haven't. There's going to be information associated with the soil types that they found, the vegetation. Again, this time of year, it's not as reliable, vegetation. So that's something that we want to see included as that report. So it's, you know, I know, you know, the product of this is lines on a page, and there's a lot of work done in between that both Norris and the peer review has done. As part of our scope of work, we mentioned that, you know, we want to see that those logs from our peer reviewer.
Now, do you take transects?
Yes.
One in the wetland and one outside the wetland. Do you do that? I didn't know if that was part of the method.
That's one of the methodologies. Typically, I don't worry too much about where the wetland is. I worry about where the upland is.
Sure. So
upland more than I'm marking the wetland. And you should know that back in the 70s, the regulations were different. It wasn't until 95 to 96 that they changed to allow the use of soils, which is a more scientific method of determining a wetland. The wetland back in before 95 was determined strictly vegetatively. To get you an idea, we classify each plant. So we would classify a red maple as a facultative species. Technically, that has a 33 to 66% chance of being in a wetland. Think of it as a 50-50 shot. It'll grow in your front yard, but it grows in a lot of wetlands.
Right.
A facultative wetland plant would be in a wetland 66 to 99% of the time. That would be a blueberry. You can grow a blueberry in your garden, but typically it's in a wetland, though there are upland blueberries.
Right.
And then there's an obligate wetland plant, which would be skunk cabbage. If you see skunk cabbage, it's a 99% chance that you're in a wetland. So,
okay, well, I actually have some pictures.
Yep.
That are in these areas. I have a bunch of pictures. I have a vernal pool picture. I do have some pictures of, I think, might be skunk cabbage. And also, in the area, go more towards the this new line, this entire area, I would say a good 20, 30 feet is filled. It's a little harder to, I think, see with the leaves and everything. and I also have pictures of these, for what I could find, was, you know, from someone I do, you know, who has some botany background, is cinnamon fern, possibly sensitive and part of the royal fern. And it starts to, in parcel 8, towards this line that starts to deviate out, it covers 50%.
There's a big patch of fern in parcel 8. That was one area where Rebecca, you during Sunday's site visit,
but I saw the cinnamon fern in the wetland area. I didn't see sensitive or royal
that
fern.
That large patch of fern is hay-scented fern, and hay-scented fern is in fact an upland fern. Not every fern is a wetland fern.
Right.
And that's precisely why we're hiring a consultant.
Right, there's a big mix, but along this area that you actually cannot see, there it's quite extensive. And then there's that where the possible vernal pool is. I know that you had moved the flag out when you were there on Monday, about 10 feet.
Yeah.
From that area.
The wetland delineation based on soils is more scientific and more accurate.
Absolutely.
It's also more labor intensive.
Course.
So we rely on vegetation a lot and topography as well. But in a site like this, it's not unusual. We'll spend a lot of time doing soil probes.
Yep, and that's absolutely fine. And that's I'm glad that, you know, this is being recognized because this is a huge discrepancy.
When it's dry, doing it by soils is going to do the people who don't want it a favor. If you do it by the vegetation, there's going to be less vegetation during a dry period.
Absolutely. But, you know, I mean, I think that we... With having an independent consultant, you know, we know at least know where these samples are being taken from. It's not to sound like total paranoia, but they are working in the best interest of the builder. Okay.
Well, so, no, the independent consultant is working for the town.
No, I'm talking about what they're finding, what Norse's findings are.
I think when we were out there Monday, we probably looked at 6 or 7 different spots. All over the site. Anytime the commission asked us to auger down, it's what we did. But we took a number of soil probes.
Was it actually you that took the soil probes and the different times that you came out here? Or was it other people?
I'm a soil scientist as well as a botanist, so I always use soils.
Okay.
It's just that you don't use soils at every single flag because it would take you all day to do a simple wetland boundary.
Understandable. But in this area where it's so... There's a lot of depressions and things like that. That I just, like I said, there's a lot of questioning between the vegetation and, especially in the spring, I understand the markings and the colorings and all that. I just feel like, you know, between this possible vernal pool and everything else, that I think the best surveying would be in the spring.
The area that you talked about was the area where we did have well-developed hydric soils, and we moved the flag a good 10 or 15 feet there, I believe.
Mm-hmm. Right, and then that was after the fact that it was questioned. So, yeah, I mean, like I said, I think the best, you know, I feel that if an independent survey or engineer at the peak time would be the best situation because these are wetlands. You can't take these back. You know, we're starting to, you know, lose a lot of wetlands in general. Yes, we're building a lot in Reading, and I just think it's something that once you start dredging and filling, and then you find out there's a mistake, you can't fix it. So I mean, it's priceless. I think that talking about, you know, money and bids and this and that, that's not really as important to me as anything else. You know, than what's going on in the wildlife and, you know, the salamanders and the frogs and things that my children bring home and whatever else, you know. I mean, this is something we can't fix after it's too late.
Understood.
Another question. She brought up about wildlife. So is that being, is this part of that? Like, are you guys looking for, I mean, obviously we're in the winter, wildlife is scarce. Is that part of any of this research?
In delineating the wetland line, it is not. However, if someone submits an application to build something within 100 feet of that wetland line, the wildlife habitat does come into play.
But not for this application?
Not for this application, only in any subsequent application to actually build something.
Lauren Sars, 25 Springdale Road. I just had a question about the placement of the flags. When they are placed, are they then documented somewhere so that when someone else comes back out, they're able to see that the flag is in the correct spot that it should be in? Because it's my understanding that some of the flags on this past visit had been removed. So I just want to make sure that once flags are placed, it's documented so that we don't have to have someone come back out and replace them.
They are surveyed in.
Okay, thank you.
Peach Fields, 31 Randall Road. Been listening to this, and I think we're working around a question. And I hear that the upcoming survey will be verifying the existing markers, if they can find them, and assuming they're still in the right place. We talked about other depressions and irregularities. If the people out there in the field see something that's, quote, suspicious, close quote, are they contractually obliged to investigate that? Some other place that doesn't have a flag now?
Our scope includes a review of the entire site for resource areas, so yes, they are contractually and professionally obligated to report that.
Okay, is this a casual observation or?
That is all based on science.
So we're hiring someone to go out there and do this. There are the marks that are on this page are out there. There's tags out there. But you know, we are hiring someone not necessarily to verify a point, but to delineate the wetlands.
I thought I heard points being verified.
Well, so there's these tags are out there as well as older tags.
Mm-hmm.
So we had the conversation of, you know, do you take every single one off? But that what the commission had decided was that it wasn't worth the effort to go and take every single one off, but they're going out there to make their own decision of where the wetlands are.
Okay. Associated with that, what do the colors of the flags mean?
Personal preference.
Really?
Yeah.
It depends on who puts
the flag.
Depends
on who puts them up. Some companies have flags with their names written on it. Some don't. Some use orange. Some use blue. Some use it's whatever they want.
I like pink and black.
And some use pink.
And black stripe.
There you go.
And not all is associated with wetlands.
Yeah, it might not be a wetland flag. It might be something.
It might be a property line. It might be a
survey marker.
There were some stakes out there, property stakes.
Yeah.
What's that?
You see, like, four different colors.
Yeah. And they do that on purpose, obviously. They come back and they say, okay, mine are pink with black stripes, so now I know these are probably my flags. So
I heard from someone that blue meant a river, and I said,
Not necessarily.
Yeah.
It makes sense.
On a map it might, but.
Okay. I heard that hearsay doesn't count, I understand. So maybe you can get a straight answer. But soil samples or wetland delineation can only occur in the spring. That's wrong.
That's not correct.
Okay. Are you
mostly forward? Incorrect, I should say. Some wetland scientists might need to see it under certain circumstances. They might need to see it in the spring, but not in all circumstances.
Okay.
Just out of curiosity, as far as the vernal pools go, I know they don't have to be certified, and there is a 100-foot buffer for them as well. Are there any protected, or shall I say, like, laws for upland protection because they do migrate further than 100 feet?
As far as I know, there's no vernal pools in that site.
The vernal pool species habitat is defined by that 100 feet, and that's what's regulated. Beyond that, it's not regulated.
Okay.
So the vernal pool habitat boundary is identified by the mean high water.
Spring high water.
Mm-hmm. The spring high water mark. And you've mentioned vernal pool. I think you're talking about parcel 5. I think this is, so here's the cul-de-sac just to the left.
Yes.
So if it's not registered with Natural Heritage, which is a state agency that you send the data to certify the vernal pool, if it's not already certified, this commission also will protect an area that is not certified but shows all the evidence required for certification. Okay, so as an additional protective measure in our bylaw regulations, we have included regions of Reading that are not officially certified.
Right, and this particular one happens to fall in part of the Norse's, and you know that.
But I
do believe that in the spring it definitely flows further out from there.
If you have data that meets those vernal pool certification requirements, then I encourage you to submit that to the commission, so that we have that as part of.
There's actually a form online where you check if an area it lists the requirements for a vernal pool. It's like a checklist, and you go through and you check them. That form is online on the BEP site under vernal pools, and you can go through that, and you can look, and you can see what makes a vernal pool.
So at this point, is that part of the records review for your notice, for your ANRAD?
We asked for all resource areas.
And that you did not find a certified vernal pool on these properties?
No, we took the map
registered
before we
with
on
the
every
state.
Site.
Or possible. Possible.
Well, that's what I'm trying to draw the distinction
between. Submitted in the package of the ANRAD.
Yeah, there was nothing. Okay. So they did not identify a state-listed certified vernal pool.
Right.
So if you have additional information, you can provide that to the Conservation Commission, and we'll consider it. By nature of what a vernal pool
right.
is. Yeah. So.
Can we see you in May on that?
We'll see.
Right.
We'll see how it goes.
No, I propose that Mr. Erickson seems pretty eager to get this whole thing done and over with. Can I propose that we wait until springtime, actually, when you know the vegetation and the after the spring thaw and everything else, and you can actually see what's a pool and what's not, how that creek actually flows and all that stuff. I mean, there's rumors that there are underground springs everywhere in that property too. So I just want to make sure we get it right. You know what I mean? Just because some builder screwed up 45, 50 years ago and just went down, tearing through the woods, I don't want, because once it's gone, it's gone. It's never coming back. So I just want to make sure it's right, and we all know it's right. We're all comfortable with the findings.
And subsequently, we can end up with water. My backyard is always flooded.
Yes, me too.
Our neighbors have.
Reading's very wet.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well,
yeah, and we're in ground zero.
But my house has been during severe rainstorms 12 years ago. Right before I bought it, it was flooded about a foot. Luckily, we had to scrape since, but you're talking about a new road and homes, and that they don't make small homes anymore. So now you're talking about the water table, that's the way it's going to start shifting, and I know they can help with that kind of stuff, but in essence, in a true wetland, that
they're actually required by law to not increase water problems.
Absolutely, right.
And that comes before us.
Right, absolutely.
So you should be aware also that the commission is obligated to act within 21 days, and if they don't, we have the right to appeal, unless we allow the extension, which typically we do. But the commission has 21 days to have a hearing. Then they have 21 days to make a decision. And if we don't get the decision within 21 days, we have the right to go to the state, and the answers from the state could be entirely different. In fact, it would probably be different.
Having said that, however, if our independent third consultant said it was impossible to delineate the wetlands until we waited until spring, we could require that additional information. We don't anticipate that, but that is a possibility, and we want another opinion on that.
And that may or may not get upheld by the state. Typically, it would be held up by the state if there was snow cover.
Okay. This about Pat Shields, 31 Randall Road. I know one of our general concerns too is once we get this started, if you look at those maps, it looks like there are wetlands that go almost all the way to West Street. If we start at our end, do you have any idea if, you know, if the builder wins on this one, is there a chance this will go all the way to West Street? Because our traffic is going to get outrageous with, I'm thrilled they're putting lights up because it's hard to get out of Westcroft, believe me. But what are the chances, you may not know, but what are the chances of other people coming along and saying, okay, let's keep on going and we'll be out to West Street and traffic will be horrendous?
It's beyond the purview of this commission.
Okay, that's fine. That was a question from the general populace.
And that actually, those words are very, very seldomly uttered at one of these meetings. Beyond the purview, so.
Gotcha.
I think Pat's point is if the lots we're looking at now, if that wetlands delineation is fiction or guesswork, why couldn't the whole rest of it be all the way to West Street?
It's a case-by-case
case
basis.
This is getting to be kind of unbelievable.
It's case-by-case.
Patricia Lloyd, I'm from the Reading Open Land Trust. The land trust owns parcels 11 and 12, which you don't see on the map, but are a little further down along that strip of property. So the landowners own lots to one side of us and to the other side of us, but we're kind of in the middle.
Excuse me. Sorry to interrupt. Pat, are you talking about on map 15 or map 10?
Yes,
okay. Okay, thanks.
And I have a timeline map if you need a copy. The Open Land Trust has owned its parcel since about 1984, and Angelini's have owned there since about 97. And in that time that we've had it, there has been a lot of filling. As you mentioned, there's historical fill, there's leaves, grass clippings, et cetera, coming into that property. When you're taking the soil samples, my question is, if there is debris, construction debris and other things on top, where are you starting the 12-inch soil sample from? Because it's going to make a huge difference. 30 years of filling shouldn't be rewarded by changing a wetland into a buildable lot. So our concern is when you go back and do the soil testing that it's done from base level, not from the top of the debris that's been brought in over time. I don't know how that's measured. Maybe the soil experts could let me know how they deal with historic fill. That would be great.
That is a hard and important question. What we typically do is we go below the leaf litter, below the any grass clippings or undergrowth that has been there, to get into the A or the organic layer. We typically, much of Reading is historic fill, as I'm sure you're aware. But we take it from the surface of the soil. If it's legal fill put in place before the Wetlands Act, that is the current elevation that we measure from.
I know that in my experience with soil evaluation from a drainage standpoint, fill layers are not like natural occurring soil layers. The weathering takes thousands of years for the soils to weather. So when you look at a soil profile, it's obvious that this is fill. This is a plow layer, which is usually about 8 inches of dark soil, and then the parent layers are underneath. So when you look at a soil profile, I assume in a boring, I know that's your experience,
I assume that that would be visible as well in a boring sample, too. I'm thinking of an open pit. But it's not something that someone who looks at soils every day would miss. It's very clear that this is fill and this is the parent soil. So even longer than hydric soils take to develop, the weathering of the soils takes thousands of years. So that's my experience with it. And I don't know how the site was done, but I suspect he could certainly speak for...
Actually, the subsoil that we have around New England was all what we call aeolian deposition. It was windblown. When the glaciers first receded, there was nothing growing here for several thousand years, probably. And the particle size for all of that subsoil there is virtually identical. You never find a rock in it, but you find somewhere around 18 to 24 inches of subsoil all through most of New England. The topsoil is typically 8 inches around here, because that's the level where the deposition of the leaves falling off the tree and the rotting of the organics reaches an equilibrium around here. So we get a typical horizon around here with the soils that we have, and it's easy to tell if it's been filled. It's impossible to tell how long it was filled unless
right.
I find a buried newspaper,
right.
But I can always tell if it's a filled site.
But what is the depth? So if it's a filled site and you still only go 18 inches down, would you go farther?
The definition of a hybrid soil is water at or near the surface for a significant portion of the year. At or near the surface is defined as 12 inches, and a significant portion of the year is 2 weeks during the growing season. In the event that I've got a site that was filled prior to 1972, and they put 2 feet of fill over a wetland, that's not a wetland anymore by the criteria set by people who are smarter than me.
The other question I have is, as far as a hydraulic connection, if there's any way to determine whether some of these depressions are not isolated wetlands, but merely separated from the other wetland due to fill, either in the last few years or historical fill. If that's something that can be looked into as well.
Well, that's why we're doing the survey, to help us understand that.
Okay. All right. No one has anything else to add?
I move we can continue this hearing until a date to be set once we receive proposals from the independent wetland consultants.
Second. All those in favor?
And just for the public, we don't know exactly what that date will be, but it will be posted 3 days in advance on the website. And Chuck, could you tell them where on the website? Because I can't always find it.
On the conservation page, on the front page too. Where you'll just see all of the calendar on the lower right-hand side, and just click on the dates and you can see what's coming up.
Our target is January 6th, but it could be a week earlier.
I'm sorry, just one more thing. And thank you all. I realize you guys are doing this all volunteer, and you guys are providing a very important service, and we thank you for that. So the next meeting that's coming up, what will that? That's just going to be about...
Just selected.
Watching the agenda.
I just
mean
sure people
have
gone
through. Select
the peer review. Okay. Thank you for coming out.
You know, people, you know, built their heads on the land to get the hell out of here. I mean, really. I mean,
anybody need a break?
Take
it
down.
Not as ugly as it could have been.
No.
We're going to get the name of this woman in the striped sweater so she can join the conservation.
Do you have any interest in doing this more?
I'll see what I can do.
Yeah, isn't that funny?
Yeah. Well, Chuck's busy with that.
Yeah.
Julie got it. You're the chair. I'm just going to sit here.
A lot of people. Can I ask you to take your conversations outside, please?
It'll be interesting.
Good community.
Jane can get them all out of here.
Hold your voices back and over that time, you'd appreciate it.
Hit the gavel. All right, I'm going to stop asking you what you're going to do.
No.
My little old self here.
Is there anybody here from Blueberry Lane? 27 Blueberry Lane?
Probably buried in the hallway.
Probably, yeah.
We'll have to wait until
they're
they
mobbed out.
Get out.
Yeah.
Are we going to hold it if they don't show up?
What was the...
It was four pine trees. Straight
pine trees. Let's see if Chuck, they've talked to Chuck.
Yeah.
Maybe they've...
We did a site visit, right?
We did a site visit. I'm sorry I didn't get around to...
Oh, you didn't go there?
Yeah, she went.
Yeah,
I went, but
went.
I took photos.
We trust what you have to say.
You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to read the minutes. Just finally got those.
Yeah, you and me too.
I just want to sit in at midnight.
Did anybody have a chance to read the minutes?
Last year
I started.
They went
out.
Yes.
I wouldn't do
just
it.
Today.
Oh, yeah.
4:30.
Oh, I did look at it.
I started.
I have some copies if anyone wants a copy.
But
I just
came in,
you know,
and
I just
talking.
Need
I
to
like,
see
I
these
can't
minutes.
Can't
to
concentrate.
You'll
be calling tomorrow
and eating.
So, here. One of the, because I just had very small things, but one of the, I thought we should strike this conversation because it's somewhat confusing to what ended up actually occurring.
Chuck,
yes, that's fine. There was one of these that, was it Harvard, where, Harvard was the one that we couldn't find. Harvard, the important part of Harvard that I want to add was we added six high bush blueberries.
Right.
There was one of these projects, it wasn't this one.
We're
giving
the minutes.
Guys, I didn't go
yeah.
Right.
One of these projects.
I dropped you off.
It was a Sullivan project.
No,
where is it?
Oh, that was
Harvard.
This was a Sullivan.
The ANRAD.
Project.
There was a
ANRAD.
In stone, and we couldn't find.
It was Whitehall.
Came way up.
Was it Whitehall?
Sunday?
Van Norden.
No, not Sunday.
Van Norden.
No,
wait,
one here.
The time before.
Oh, okay.
No, that Van Norden, that the vernal pool boundary was to be moved to the edge of the wetland.
Oh, that's 149.
149
Van
Norden.
Norden.
Yeah, he made those adjustments, and
he
can probably approve that.
Agreed with that.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Mr.
What are we talking about?
The minutes.
For the minutes on 149 Van Norden, I had that Mr. Sullivan, Jack Sullivan agreed that the vernal pool boundary would equal the wetland delineation line. Because he had delineated the vernal pool approximately 20 feet.
Get him, Brian.
This is so rude. This is really is.
No, you just...
He's
sounds good.
I apologize.
But that's just
sounds good.
Yep. Gets him out of his chair.
Okay, perfect.
All right.
Not for Blueberry Land?
Are we going through, why don't we do the minutes later?
That's right.
After we go through the actual.
Okay. You got Chuck.
I don't know where you guys are.
Blueberry Lane.
So Blueberry Lane. No? Did you talk to anybody from Blueberry Lane? Or should we
let's wait just in case somebody is stuck out there. Not everybody's out yet.
No. All right.
I did talk to somebody from Blueberry Lane, but no one told me I was representing them. I know a little bit about it. But did anyone go to this site?
I can tell you what I know about it. Okay, go ahead, and then I'll tell you about the site visits.
Well, let me hold on. Are we going to hold the hearing?
Are we
going to
hold the hearing?
If not, let's just table it. Move on. And if we don't know everything about it.
The applicant said he was going to be here. All right, so let's table it.
Okay, great.
He said he was going to try. He might be having trouble with parking.
Yeah.
So we're not having a meeting for another month. Is the only thing I just want to make this.
It's just to cut down some trees.
Okay.
4 pine trees.
How was that? Okay.
All right. So let's table that. All right. So we'll table
it's
that.
It's up to you.
This is Whitehall. If you want to take
okay,
care of that.
Okay. Yeah. Let's do that. 61 Whitehall Lane. Order of conditions. You sent them to us ahead of time. Are there any comments?
I received no comments.
I didn't have any comments. I looked at it, but I didn't have any comments.
I give you comments.
Okay.
Any comments on 49 Van North, 149? I did not have any comments.
All right. I'm gonna just go through a little checklist here.
Which one are we
what
doing?
What are we talking
Whitehall.
About?
Let's do
Whitehall,
one at a time.
61 Whitehall, right?
Yes.
Is that what we were talking about?
Yes.
Right.
Okay, that's what I'm talking about as well.
I was confirming. I wouldn't send
comments
for the one.
So a little checklist I wrote down for this one. So we needed to keep the stockpiled soil out of 35 feet. And equipment out of 35 feet. Chuck, was that in the order of conditions? Keep stockpiled soil out of 35 foot. That's usually part of our standard conditions.
Yeah, that's boilerplate.
So that's, okay.
Yeah.
Planting needs to be proposed to offset the loss of the 24
feet.
Foot oak.
No,
that's to be removed. Sugar maple, that was gonna be a sugar or red maple.
There's two choices on this. Stockpiles should be located at least 50 feet from the shoreline vegetated wetland.
Okay.
And what's that? I know that that's in here. I know I saw it from here.
It's a good thing I take notes, otherwise I can't remember. Really can't.
So there's two trees that are going to be planted.
So that's item 4 on page 15.
Did you find it?
Yeah. The applicant proposes to plant 6, and then you have a 2 in parentheses. Red maples or sugar maples to restore a zone of natural vegetation within the inner buffer. So what is it, 6 or 2?
Probably 6 2-inch, no?
No, it's probably something left in there. I can't find it. It's page 15.
Page 15 or our page 2, item 4.
Did you print those out?
Six sounds excessive. I think 2 is. I think 2 is probably
the
number it should have been.
Yeah, I would think so.
I think you guys are the number. I don't think we've ever asked for 6 in place of 1. So let's correct that on item 4. There's an item in here, Jamie's infamous no cutting of healthy trees.
It's in there.
Okay.
I like the
look. All right. Operation and maintenance plan for the Cultec. Did we get that?
It's listed in the documents.
Okay.
Weren't there changes to that though? Like
it's revised also in the document list.
Okay.
Okay. So
okay.
We've got major storm defined.
What's that?
We've got major storm defined.
In the actual operation and maintenance plan.
In providing a log?
They're providing a log. It's actually
okay.
In it. I think that was sent to you on.
Okay.
The new one? The new one.
I must have. Should I mark it this one? Oh.
Okay, well, if the operation maintenance plan is updated, I think the other thing was waiting for, if you got the DEP number and the green cards.
All that.
All right, grab a motion.
I think we already approved it at the previous meeting. Now we just have to sign it.
Yeah. Okay.
Motion to close. Did you motion, and then you motion to approve tonight, right? And then you sign?
I move we approve the order of conditions as drafted.
I think we already approved the order of check the minutes, but we approved the order of conditions to be drafted in compliance with what we talked about. I don't think we need to vote on it again. You just need to look at it and confirm that it's what we wanted
it to say. Right.
Yeah, I think that's typically what we've done.
Yeah, that's what you guys do. You say yes, and then
there's no comments. You sign. You just send it around.
Yeah, we're always getting confused. There's usually a two-step process. It's close and then approve. So close, write the order, read the order, approve, sign.
That's right.
So
we need to approve it.
I think we did approve it.
Last meeting we closed. And we approved.
Right.
We did both.
Right.
Okay.
Specifically remember.
Right.
Because we struggled with it.
But the minutes say all we did was close.
From now on.
So the minutes, so
make
let's make an additional
to
motion.
It
to
once
approve.
We see it. I think that makes sense to me. I mean,
I guess. I'll get a glass of water.
I move we approve.
Usually you put me on the right page.
The order of conditions.
Going?
Oh, sorry, man.
The reason, Brian, that we approve it is we approve it.
Like 2 seconds.
Stop the clock.
We approve it.
Thank you.
While the meeting is still open, the people are still here. They can hear our decision. The applicant knows we've approved it. Knows all we got to do is put in on black and white what we said, and they can go ahead with their planning. I mean, if in this case it was a month ago, I believe.
So that's
the rationale of approving it and authorizing Chuck to draft the order of conditions in conformance with the discussion.
Do we want to continue that practice?
I would be in favor of it.
I think
it.
So. Okay. I mean, I think just what Jamie said, that the usually the homeowner's here.
All right. Well, then we'll continue what we were doing. So all we need to do is sign it here.
The only time that you haven't done both was when there was a question whether I could get it finished or not.
Right. Now, do you have any questions about the order conditions? Were you able to view a copy?
No, I'm good. I understand.
Okay.
Be flexible, whatever.
Excellent.
Yeah. It was reasonable.
Thank you.
Okay.
You want 6 trees? I'll plant 6 trees.
And there's a 10-day appeal period, so you really can't start your project for 10 days as of tomorrow.
This is the springtime.
Great.
Okay.
Would you guys like the door left open? Or?
Yes,
please open the door.
Thank you. So moving on to 149 Van Dorn Road, I know somebody over here has comments on that.
So, are you pointing?
Well, you were talking about it.
Oh.
I know 149, go ahead. I gave Chuck some minor comments
okay.
to the order of conditions earlier today.
Order of resource
area. I'm sorry,
it was
not an order of conditions, it was...
149 Van Norden Road, Wilson. Are there any other comments?
A couple of flags were moved. Did we get an updated plan?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
And so you've does that plan show that the certified vernal pool boundary is also the wetland flag
yes.
line? Then I'm good.
Okay. You have that for us to sign.
Yep.
I do, right here.
Okay, 26 Harvard Street. No DEP file number.
No, we got that late this afternoon. Like I told you the number.
I hope that wasn't the one I read for the...
0652. 0652.
Oh, that's the one.
652.
Did you say that?
That was, yeah.
I probably did, yeah.
Yes.
Oh, well. That's why I asked you, do you have a DEP number for this for this hearing? And he gives me the... So, Harvard Street. Sorry. Harvard Street. Any comments on the Harvard Street order of conditions?
I think the only comment would be
there's no DEP
number. Just use the line that they provided from 2012.
Okay.
No one thinks it's accurate, but they said to use it. So
it's
in there, and
okay.
That line that's on their grass has been approved for the next 3 years.
Yeah, I mean, we've got it. They said they accepted it at the last meeting. So.
Do you have it for us to sign there?
I do.
Excellent. Determination of applicability, 28 Oak Street.
What is DOA, dead on arrival?
Yeah.
On arrival, man.
Determination of applicability. DOA. Any comments on that one?
Which one was the phone?
Okay. That's the... Yeah, I had a comment. I didn't know... I had forgotten whether we accepted the 2-year warranty by the installer, or was it the $1,000 bond?
We voted for them to apply a $1,000 bond.
I did make a phone call and did not receive a $1,000 bond, so we should not.
So we'll pass on that.
Pass on that one.
Okay.
They said they had no problem.
I thought it was the bond. I had it written in my notes, but I said this is not showing up, and I'm not getting a phone call.
But you don't have the bond.
Wait a minute. Can we require a bond?
On a
negative determination? I'm not sure we can.
Is it a negative determination?
Yeah.
But we did require a bond.
I'm not sure we can.
We did, and the applicant accepted it, so.
But he didn't pay it.
Well, then we're not going to sign this.
I think that just doesn't matter. I mean, you say whatever you want.
Let's think about this a minute. If we require a bond on a negative determination of applicability, when does he get that money back? Because we don't issue a certificate of compliance. So when do they get it back?
When we say so.
2 years. I thought we gave a period
The guarantee period is,
right? We gave
him
two growing seasons.
Yeah.
I thought we gave a period.
So if that's
A 2-year guarantee for replacement of the lawn.
Yeah.
And then in the bond, it will cover if it fails and they don't replace it.
At least they give you 30% loss. And so many trees, and $1,000 should cover it. We're going to take that letter from the lawnmower and the pickup truck.
I was going to say, that's right, the lawnmower and the pickup truck. Remember that. So we have an RDA, and we had some conditions. You're never supposed to have conditions with
right.
an RDA.
Right.
But the applicant needed to decide whether this would be kicked up so we can have our conditions in a notice of intent. I'm sure he didn't want that. So he accepted what we offered.
Probably cheaper.
But he did that work before he came before us, right?
Yeah, he wanted to get that done.
That was done. We didn't even,
yeah.
He did
I
it without approval?
Yeah,
yeah.
I actually have our site visit in the order of conditions, if you read it.
Yeah.
This isn't it, so. But he did it about 2 weeks after that.
Yeah.
And I think it was like October, wasn't it? Like,
It was a little late.
Like November,
and I mean,
was,
I think they'll probably be fine, but I mean, that's why, you know, we wanted a bond. That was the only guarantee that to replace them if they died.
So if you haven't heard from them, then let's.
You can sign it, and I can tell them just give me the bond, and I won't issue it. Or you can not.
But he's already done the work.
Yeah, he's done the work. It's all about just survivability
just
at this point.
Survival.
No,
he did the work before he came before us.
So what do we want to do?
Why didn't we issue an enforcement order?
No, it's fine. The work is fine. The site's fine.
Well, he did the work with that authorization.
Well, we should have done that when he was here at the last meeting.
A whole lot
of
things done at
that
site without authorization.
Yeah, I mean, this was a site with a whole lot of...
But we accepted that at our last meeting.
Yeah.
Right.
Correct.
So, did I give you 28 Oak Street?
Are we,
no.
Are we not going to sign it, or what is the sense of the commission?
Up to you. You can sign it, and I can ask him for
it,
the bond. I think
it.
This guy will come in right away, or you can just hold off. It's up to you.
What is
he's really not waiting.
I would hold off.
For this at all. Yeah, I don't think he is anyway.
Yeah, I mean, it's not like he's in a rush. I will.
The only time he'll be in a rush is when his when he needs his occupancy.
Yeah.
But I can table this until the next meeting.
All right, let's
I'm in approval.
Let's do that.
Yeah, let's wait till the money's there and we'll sign.
104 Scotland Road, minor project, pool deck skating rink. I saw an email with regards to
this. This isn't our favorite site on Scotland Road.
Yeah.
It is. It's a good one.
Pool deck and skating rink.
How far is he from the wetlands with the pool deck and the skating rink?
Pool deck's a ways away, but
yeah,
the skating rink is...
Yeah, you're 80 feet away with the pool. You might be 75 feet away with the deck. The pool is definitely 80-plus feet away. And those are allowed under the minor project. Because they have that language like auxiliary structure.
Mm-hmm.
Is it above ground?
It's all above
ground.
Yep.
Pool, yeah.
What about skating rink?
Skating rink is a temporary structure,
but it's very
close. It's 15 to 20 feet away. And I did have a conversation, and this is the first time that someone's been 15 or 20 feet away from a Reading jurisdictional wetland.
That's not true.
Well.
While you've seen.
I love it. Well, see, you go over there. Come on. That's the GIS thing going.
No.
I'm not trying to bash on you, but I have seen.
We did approve another one.
And I did send an email out to the commission. So the whole point is, this thing's going to be gone in the spring. But it is 15 feet away. Thinking frozen ground, on lawn. You know, I mean, I would almost describe this guy as very helpful for that wetland area and that natural area. I mean, his kids are using it. I get that. But he did clean it up. He makes sure no one dumps in there. Very vigilant about that. And is it completely natural? No, it's not. But is it better than it was? It is. And he understands the rules right now. But that aside, he's putting a temporary structure, frozen water, 20 feet away from the edge of, and that 20 feet is grass, from the edge of the wetland. And in the spring, he says he actually pumps it out, and there's a drain on his property.
Away from the wetland and away from the rink. It's between
the
rink and the deck.
I mean, even if he didn't, there's gonna be no chlorine left in that water. So
I don't have any objection to
this.
In
the
skating, no, we're talking
about
the ice
skating rink.
Right.
The pool.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I mean, if there's any chlorine residual from the tap water that he uses, it's gonna be long gone by that time. So.
Yeah,
it's not. There's not going to be.
When it's
going to
be a slow melt.
When they
is this a plastic lined on?
Yeah.
What's the frame?
Wood.
Do we know?
It's wood.
No, yeah, I do. It's two.
Go ahead.
Do you want to do? I know you love
construction. No, no. You know better than me. Go ahead.
It's 2x12s. It's just 2x12s by 16 feet long. He's made it out of that.
I have no issues with it.
Or 2x10s, or I think it's 2x10s, maybe. And he didn't have a liner in it, but I would assume that's going to be plastic. And you just put out a layer every cold night, and then you just build up on that as it goes.
Oh, so he's actually constructed the frame.
Yeah, I saw the frame when I went out to look at the sonotubes, and I called him and I asked him about it. I told him I needed you guys to weigh in on it.
We did a site visit.
If you wait until snow, you actually don't need a liner.
You don't. Maybe he's not using a liner at all. But he's going to pump it out in the spring, so... But he's going to spoil all his fun if he doesn't have a liner.
We did
do
a site visit.
Check?
What's that?
What are the dimensions?
Off the top of my head, I think it's like two.
It's big.
By
it's big.
Three. So what? So 32 feet by 50? 60,
whoa.
62?
It's big.
Yeah.
Something 30, like that.
32 by 50?
Yeah.
Yep.
And of course, you don't need to fill it up all 10 inches.
No, I know. Yeah, they just need a few inches. I don't have a problem with it either. I'm just curious.
So I don't know. I mean, so I didn't know if this is a problem, but I do know that there was one on Orange. Was that Orange where we had the ex-select woman
Oh, yeah, I remember that one.
They always had one, but theirs was on a terrace at least 35 feet away. They had a pool. This was a professional pool, though, metal and real liner and all that, and bleachers or whatever they used.
Whose property was it on?
Who's the ex-female selectman that you know her?
Camille Anthony.
Yeah.
Did you mean a pool with stands or ice skating with stands?
No, an ice skating rink. I made up the stands. I mean, come on.
You can't tell what you do.
We get confused.
There's some kids.
I wasn't there. I don't know.
Yeah. I have no objection to it.
All right, so we're fine with it. We don't have to vote on it.
So anytime someone puts it up, as long as it exists in line, we're good from now on.
Yeah, I mean, it's temporary. It's not a big deal.
Okay.
Now, do you have any reports over there, administrative reports?
Well, we have... We get the Blueberry Lane here. I was going to go over a few things. I hear tell that the finances for this year, if you looked at that chart, you can see that we're pretty much keeping up with our minor project permits and our RDAs are still about the same. Orders of conditions have dropped, and the ORADs are the same, and then the extensions were still within that Extension Act, but the money that we've raised has dropped dramatically.
What's an AMOOC?
Amended Order of Conditions.
Oh, it's an amendment to an Order of Conditions.
Yeah, yep, an amendment to an Order of Conditions. An extension. You know, you gotta understand that we're in the Extension Act, and that's why that's not up. But I just wanted to draw your attention to the fact that there's a little bit less money this year, and we're still doing the offset, which we'll be voting on. So there's a $4,000 offset that we usually give the town to offset my salary or offset the conservation office. And I don't have the sheet with me, but I think we just have a little bit over that this year. My sheet actually doesn't have a total. Do you guys have a total for state fees, which would be the WPA fees?
2502.
That's for 2015.
For 2015, yeah.
2502?
Mm.
For this.
So that 2502 plus the money that we have in it brings us to about $5,500. So we're going to be an operating expense of $1,500. And we usually do $300 for MACC conference, and then $700 or $600 and something for our dues for MACC. So it's right down to the wire.
We just can't pay it. We're going to have to work for free.
Well, I already talked to Jean, and she understood that this was the last year that they'd be able to get that offset. But I don't know if that, it sounded like, what can you do about it? But again, when every other department is giving their offset, you know, the reason why we don't have one is when I first got here, it was like $15,000. And it's just been offset. For the last couple of years, maybe it was a little bit less.
What do you mean offset? You mean giving money from our fee to help
offset my salary or the office?
We anticipate a 2.5 override next year because, as Chuck said, all the departments are in
hot water.
Yeah.
Except for recreation. But Jamie, when do they vote on that? Is that November? In November?
It will probably be November. What will happen when come for 10 meeting in the spring, they have to approve it, and then it has to go to general election.
Right, so that's where we are.
So town with no money, the lights look pretty good out there.
Yeah.
Don't they?
They do.
They do. Would you take those lights down?
No. I'd override.
You got to keep the population happy.
Right.
So they keep paying your salary.
Now this
I don't know if that makes him happy.
there was another override in like 2013, wasn't there?
I don't think 13, maybe 8 or 9.
No, sorry, no. There was an override for the library, mm-hmm. But there was also one in 2003 is what I meant.
Yeah. One startling fact, as far as dollars spent per student, Reading ranks something like 307th. Out of 342 towns and cities in Massachusetts.
Lowest dollar spent?
Pretty low.
What's the amount
really?
Per student?
No.
It's
no.
Still 6,000.
I'm aware of that one.
I can't remember. That sounds about right. But we are, and if you take the 42 cities and towns in the area, we're like about 38th, 37th.
No.
We're spending
I
less
schools
on our
rated,
schools.
School's rated pretty high, though.
It is, and we're doing well. The issue is many of our good teachers have been here a long time, don't want to leave, but we can't get any good new teachers because our salaries are so much lower than the surrounding towns.
Hmm.
And that number's been trending down. I mean, that's the number that they've been looking at and saying is the concerning one.
Yes.
It's just consistently been heading in the wrong direction.
Right. We can withstand a few bad years, but the trend of 5-6 years going down, we just can't hire good teachers. Why would you work here 60-70% of the salary when you can get in Melrose?
Well, it seems like teachers don't.
I can tell you, I'd rather have my kids going to Reading than Melrose to school.
Melrose is pretty good.
So
Wakefield, I don't know about
it.
Melrose is not bad.
What's your over and under on the override?
What do you mean?
Do you think it'll pass?
It'll pass town meeting. I don't know if it'll pass general election.
It sounds like the schools. I mean, that's a good argument if you want to get good teachers in.
And we're also one
it's
of
a
the
big
few,
election too.
We're one of the few towns in the metropolitan area that don't have all day kindergarten.
Right. That's a big issue with a lot of people.
Do you intend to pay for that here in this town? Would you pay for the entire day? Because I know they don't do that in a lot of other places.
Well, many towns get subsidy from the state for all-day kindergarten.
Which
someone,
the town would be
entering
eligible for.
Arlington for all-day kindergarten is ponying up $5,000.
Well, we do have an all-day kindergarten that's got to pay tuition, but there are more applicants for it than there are space, so they select them on a lottery basis.
Yeah, that's not good. All right, back to conservation.
Well, I don't know if there's anything we can do with this.
What, was there just a building boom in like the mid-2000s? Because weren't the big projects going on, like Home?
Home Depot was like finished in 04, 05.
Yeah, big bucks that, those years.
When you look at the order of conditions issued, I mean, 31 in 2005, and it's trending, it's 14 this year.
Look at 2011. It was less than 2011, too.
Well,
yeah.
That was not a very good year.
I mean, after 2009 through 2012, I think everything was slow.
Yeah, exactly.
So
those are numbers you would expect to
see.
Is
that
a
reflection
of the slow
2008.
Economy?
When you do the math
on
this spreadsheet, you have to take into consideration this very generous Conservation Commission. And I'll just remind you a few.
Giving back money.
Camp Curtis Guild,
right.
$21,000. You know, Pizza World, Austin Prep, there's others that don't rank up in that.
And I think what happened in 2012 and 2013 were a couple of big developments, wasn't there? I mean, Pulte Homes came through one.
Oh, right,
Pulte
Homes.
Gary's Greenhouse, Artist,
yeah.
Well, I wasn't here for Pulte, that was already written with me, but it might have been 2012.
Yeah.
Keep in mind, too, you issue an order of conditions for a pool 38 feet from the wetlands, but you also issue one order of conditions for Pulte Homes.
Right.
So, I mean, just the numbers
the
are
numbers
not...
The numbers don't, yeah.
They're not everywhere.
Well, it's the... Well, we're looking at fees,
yeah.
So I don't know how...
Yeah, I'm saying with
yet.
The numbers, that's
yeah.
by the
yeah.
fees.
Oh. So, I know that... Big projects bring in big fees, and that's
right.
That's,
well, and that's
how it works.
I think that's reflected in our town fees. Those are pretty,
you know,
those are
have seen,
those projects are reflected.
I mean, even the regulations, the RBG are down, and that would, you know, that's definitely artist. I think artist was in,
yeah.
Would have been, not artist, Austin Prep.
Well, I mean, there's nothing you can really do about it unless we curb the generosity, but I mean, there's...
Right. I mean, I think you're right. We did a lot of projects, but we did a lot of town projects.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, obviously towns.
Right.
High school
right.
paid nickel, and we spent
West Street.
Thousands of hours. On
West Street, yeah, a lot of time on West Street. I'll tell you.
Ivy Lane.
Ivy to Belmont.
That's not over.
What?
That's not over, right? That's we still have to go back, and there's a certificate of compliance needed for that, and we want to see some vegetation start growing, and then there might be some more. So that's not
tonight, though.
Yeah.
And then there's this trash can out there.
Oh, no way.
Cement garbage can. You know those old-fashioned ones?
Yeah, he said he was going to remove it.
He did. He
threw it in the wetlands.
It needs to freeze.
George can carry that. It's not that heavy. Come on.
George
is retiring. What, next month?
Oh my God, June, isn't it?
June.
This spring.
June.
So that's the finances. The enforcement. I got a great suggestion from somebody. It's I'm going to be putting enforcement on your site gender lists, and if you guys choose to go and look at those with a few notes from me and decide that we need to do something, then we'll do something.
Do you have some in mind?
Nothing right now. Oh, I think Anikin has...
I just want to add to that. So one of the groups I'm connected with on Facebook is the town of... Did you hear?
No, someone told me you were all over Facebook or something.
I wasn't all over. Anyway, there's a group of Reading parents. There's a group on Facebook of Reading parents, and every once in a while, you know, people will post something that's sort of a local issue. Like some people will say something about how crazy people drive around one corner of one road, or you know, just these little localized issues that.
That's probably me.
Who you know, and it typically tends to be like a parents group. So, but one of the things that came up was somebody took photos of a contractor's pickup truck.
Sure.
That and there was a big write-up with a number of pictures, and it basically said, I'm going to sort of summarize what she said, was look out for these guys. They take cash only. They'll take your leaves. They'll go dump it in the wetlands. And oh, by the way, if anybody catches that, that's a $10,000 fine. I'm calling the police. I'm sending a photo of these guys' license plate to the police. And so it started this whole buzz about there's a couple trucks with a couple of, you know, give me a couple bucks cash, I'll take care of your leaves. And really, and this person who posted this said that she sees them drag the tarp over and dump it in the wetlands, and she was all aflame because she said that's illegal, and that violation can get you a really lovely $10,000 fine.
Where did the $10,000 come from? Because we tried like hell to find out what the fine was, and we never could find that out.
I did not...
Remember?
I did not join the conversation except to say, if you have information, please get it to get it to the Conservation Commission so that we had the evidence. I mean, I didn't know what... I wasn't gonna take over, you know, telling this person exactly everything that needed to happen, but I just wanted to make sure the information was put out there so that we knew about it as well.
And 15 years from now, that'll be a building lot.
Well, and I also wanted to feed back to everybody here that, you know, I think sometimes in filling, like especially this compost fill situation, we seem to not have enough of a consensus lately to issue a ticket and do what needs to be done and stand by the full enforcement, because I know our town manager has instructed us with, if you're going to issue a ticket, you better be prepared to use the full weight of town council to claim it and to get the ticket, the value of the ticket paid in, and have a real sense of enforcement so that we can start preventing some of these fill situations in the future.
Well, Anika, if I remember correctly, we went through this in one of those sites where the person behind their property had all the leaves. And Chuck looked into how we could issue a fine, and I think it was only the police that could issue a ticket. We could not.
We have a ticketing authority, and we could issue an enforcement order first with some
instruction. Is it under the town dumping law or under the wetlands protection?
That one on Pinevale was particularly tough because it wasn't on that gentleman's property.
It was on town conservation land,
right.
off his property.
But
it wasn't wetlands, it was conservation.
For conservation land or for jurisdictional wetlands on private
probably
land?
Probably only for the jurisdictional wetlands. That would have been...
Is that under the Wetlands Protection Act or under our bylaw?
Under our bylaw, we have a fee schedule.
We have a fee schedule.
Yeah.
There's a fee schedule for putting
leaves
in the
wetlands? We have a fee, but a violation schedule, too.
I don't think it's not very high, though.
No. Like, the first one's $25.
$20 or something, yeah.
Yeah. Not.
I would like to see us come up with some sort of enforcement policy. I think we can maybe cash in on some public support, some sense of bad stewardship, and some. Some sentiment
around. I
don't
think the public's going to be supporting that.
Well, I think some people out there are going to be supporting that.
Well,
I think the people who are not doing the right thing aren't. Of course, they're not going to support it.
I'll step in. My wife is on the same Facebook group, and she actually pointed me to this when it happened. And there was a lot of reaction to this.
Well, listen, a contractor being paid to clean up a bunch of yards in those giant trucks and then dumping it somewhere, that's a whole different story than a homeowner over 20 years putting a compost pile 20 or 30 feet past a line they didn't know exist.
I don't disagree. And we had this conversation last meeting a little bit, is that if there's going to be a stepped up enforcement, there also has to be an effort for education and an effort for warning and an effort to say, hey, look, there is the ability to enforce. We will enforce. We want to make sure you're aware that that's the case.
We're going to educate first.
I would be an advocate of educating first.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, in the 10 years that I've been on, 10 or more years I've been on the commission, we've only issued fines two or three times, and I cannot tell you how much work we went through, and of those two or three, we only actually collected money on one of them. After years. So you're right, it's not to be taken lightly.
So I think there's also an aspect of not just the money, but while we're here, the protection of the wetlands, and let's make sure that people are aware that if it's something that continues to happen, and those are the situations I think you're talking about where it probably arose where there was something egregious or there was something that continued to happen, or I think you're right. Education is the first step. An enforcement order is, at the end of the day, the best way to, I don't want to say set your will, but to actually get reaction, though.
We've had some success with those letters. Remember we send letters to people on the street where we see the leaves and the wetlands at the end of the street.
I've gotten calls. These guys calling me. This is part of their argument over at Randall Road, is the commission sent letters calling that a wetland. We shouldn't dump out there, so why is this guy allowed to build there? So they're reading them. I don't know if it stopped them or not. I didn't see any fresh evidence, but
now they're dumping it down.
It is very difficult. I mean, do you want to go down that road? And it's a lot of work. It's a lot of hassle, and you know, not everyone rolls over when you send them a letter. So a lot to it. There's some huge piles out there, though. Really,
yeah,
almost ridiculous. I'd be embarrassed if that was. I mean, we need more guys like that at 104 Scotland Road. Like, we should get him to buy every one of these areas.
Well,
he'd clean it up and keep everybody off there.
Yeah.
Like,
but he is also getting a lot of feedback from his neighbors, you know. And it's not all positive about what he's doing there. And one of his neighbors, historically, it's true, has also been pumping their sump pump discharge right at that fence line.
The one right on the corner of West and Scott.
Adjacent to that former Open Land Trust plot. So, you know, not every person is going to be, you know, protective or responsible for their own land, you know. So we do need some sort of strategy, I think, to move this forward. And I like the idea of public education, a whole campaign. You know, you were talking, Al, about going down to RCTV, and maybe we can put in a spot.
Am I the only one that gets those patch emails every 2 weeks from...
I used to get them, and somehow I got dropped from it.
From what's her name at City Hall. It's not patch, it's...
I get those.
Yeah, I mean,
the community updates. Bi-weekly
updates.
Yeah, I get those.
Yeah, if you put it on that, it'll be a
couple
weeks.
I get a lot of other.
Just a blurb. You know, if you want more education, if you want to learn more what you can and can't do, contact our administrator. There's rules about dumping and filling. And maybe we could set some guidelines about what Chuck was saying. I mean, something egregious, you know, I would be a lot more inclined to maybe do something about, but... So a lot of this minor stuff, I mean, you're just chasing your tail. You're not getting 25. You're not going to, it's going to cost him man hours and time and money. We're never going to get anything out of it. And,
well,
you know, that's not really 20 square feet.
The only thing that would be really good, if we could change the bylaw so that if I saw something, I could just write a $10 ticket without anyone's input. And I have 300 or 400 of those out there. Some of them are going to.
You just want to be a police.
Well, it's a revenue generator.
They don't be a gun. You
want to
carry a gun.
I don't think we should or can rely on those as a revenue generator.
I don't think we should.
No, you can't rely on it.
Just,
it just happens.
How do you make it work? How do you make it simple? And obviously, taking into consideration, people aren't going to pay attention to it. You know.
Well, and it's a lot of it is circumstance. You know, what about somebody? You know, you show up. There's a pile behind the house. Well, they just bought the house 3 months ago in January. And in the spring, you show up and there's a pile back there. They didn't put it there.
So you want
there's issues
my answer
like that,
or
too.
You want the
well, I know what you're
going to
say.
Answer.
You're
going to
say, too bad, you own the property.
No, you want
you,
my answer,
you, have to
you
take
want
care
the
of
regulation
it.
Answer. 3 years, man, they own it.
Mm-hmm. Well, the wetland might not be on their property.
But I thought,
but
Phil,
they own any dumping for 3 years according to the wetland.
But no, I thought Phil was
an
ongoing violation.
On their property.
Oh, is it only on their property? Oh, yeah. If it's off their property, then they can say, I don't know who did it.
But Chuck, I thought Phil was an ongoing violation from the day it happened to every subsequent day.
It is.
So anytime it's still present, it's still an ongoing violation of filling of wetlands. That's how it was explained to me, and I didn't think there was an expiration date on
that.
Hard
line. I mean, I
well,
think
like
stat
Pat
somewhere.
Said tonight, you know, if we're talking 50 years or 30 years, which is probably the case in Randall Road,
That Phil and Randall Road is from the basements that were dug when they built the houses, or
right.
some road.
Right.
It's huge.
Right. It's dump
lot. Trucks
years ago.
Full of
years
stuff.
Ago.
Just
it came out of these people's lives.
It did.
Where
yeah.
It
did.
Came
yeah.
Out.
Well, right.
Yeah.
But that was the interesting point she brought up was, this is historic, Phil. You know, so are we going to call that a current violation? It's like, no,
well,
we can't realistically.
You can't go back. You
can't
change the history. You can't change the regs.
All back
right.
Bay is Phil. We're going to find all those people.
Yeah.
Right. Well, it goes back to our canal, you know, back on, you know. So we've got reality as it is today. But if there is ongoing...
So this is a great segue into my next thing, because I know we could talk about this all night. So one suggestion came up that this commission, we got this at MACC last year, to have a strategic planning meeting between the commission that was just a special meeting where we could talk about things that where you want to be, set an agenda, maybe a couple of goals, and to have this more lengthy discussion about if we're going to even do anything about violations or not. So that's up to you guys, but it's still, look at how it looks like. Oh my God, let's have it at his house.
I think that's a great idea, because typically when this conversation comes up, it's at the end of a meeting.
Yeah.
Everybody's interested in going home.
And it should be once a year. I mean, you just got to get into it. That's all.
I would fully support that. I would also fully support having a distinct agenda with time slots for each one.
Oh yeah.
So that it doesn't just degenerate into a gossip bitch section.
Yeah. That sounds great. And now that we've taken back ownership of Matera Cabin, we can do it there. Or Jamie, I don't know. I heard you had a party once at your house. Maybe your house will work.
I think we've had several very productive meetings at Matera Cabin.
Okay. Matera's great.
Actually, I've been, for one reason or another, I've been going out there the last few days, and I've noticed every time I've been going by there, there's been at least one vehicle there.
I was there this afternoon, and there was
maybe
a vehicle.
Yours. Oh.
Well, there was a vehicle there when I showed up.
I saw one the other day, too. I drove by.
Oh, is it unusual that people use that?
Oh, yeah. I mean, for years, I'd go by there and never see anybody.
Oh, really?
When I was there one time, somebody from a dog service in North Reading, I struck up a conversation with her, and she goes there regularly.
Okay. She takes the dogs?
She takes the dogs.
Does she have the bags?
I hope she cleans
she
up.
Does. She was responsible, but I talked to her a little bit about stewardship and management of the dogs, and she said, you know what they do in this other town that she really liked was they issued a license, and she would be all in favor of paying a license to the town of Reading.
Oh, that's
not
idea.
Our thing.
But you know, to walk.
Sure.
They take doggy DNA samples too, so if you leave.
Well, they do the license in Arlington too, so we have dog packs that you
if,
buy into
if
the dog.
If you require a license, then you're going to have somebody go out there and check people to see if they have their license.
Right, they do have two
dogs
part-time dog officers.
Yeah, dogs, yeah.
They do.
I mean,
brand new.
If you
so
issue a
license
to walk your dog on public
to
property.
Use the property.
Then you have to police it. Just requiring a license is bad policy.
That's right.
Well, knowing certain populations in Reading, they might just police themselves.
I don't know. You're going to need that. Someone.
I don't know. Have you
well,
been out in Tan Forest?
This
oh
is
my
great
goodness.
For the strategy.
And I've been
well,
back then.
This is
maybe
a great,
for the executive set.
It's a great topic
strategic.
For the strategy meeting.
And the last thing on my list was attendance and... It's not just attendance, it's kind of everything. It's kind of, well, not everything. It's attendance and it's other things. If you're not coming to the meeting, when you get to the meeting, people ask me, hey, is Al coming to the meeting? No, Al would probably let me know, but I just want to ask everyone, if you know you're not going to go to the meeting, you got to send an email. It's like the hub. Everything comes into the conservation office. If you could let me know what's going on. You're not going to be at the site visit. People ask, hey, did you hear from so-and-so? I don't know. No one knew if you were going to show up, all right?
When? Today?
Today. And then Rebecca said, you sent someone an email that she was attached to, but no one else was. And I'm like, oh.
It was Patricia.
I mean, I assumed you were coming because I didn't hear you weren't, but.
I typically, yeah. I mean, I'll tell you if I'm not going to be here, but if I don't say anything, then it's.
And I think our attendance, I don't know if it's accurate, but it's not outrageous. It's not outrageous. Only a few people have missed more than four. So, and I think we had a couple meetings off, which might have helped out a little bit. But
yeah.
Well, we had canceled at least two, if not four meetings.
Yeah.
Yeah, we canceled a few. So I thought it was working out when I went through the numbers, but still that's not bad. And we did have an agenda.
Is that something Gene asked you to do?
What's that?
Is that something Gene asked you to do?
I did it on my own. Do you want me to send her the information? No.
That matter to me.
Can we talk about site visits?
Yeah.
Are we still doing Sunday mornings? Is there a possibility to do them Monday afternoon?
I'm fine with that, but I have a fairly flexible schedule, so.
I actually
support the Monday afternoon. Despite being at work, I'm more likely to take an hour for, you know, particularly around lunch to leave. And Sundays just, a lot of weekends I'm not around, so. Sundays don't work out well for me a lot of times. So.
Starting next month, I teach on Monday.
At that time, around 1 o'clock?
No, but I couldn't do a site visit. And then, I mean, I need to be there before I teach, so I couldn't do it Sunday.
Well, it sounds like it works for more people than it doesn't. How about you? Is that
Al's
not?
Pretty flexible.
Al will go anytime you
want to
go.
We'd almost want it. To find a time that Al couldn't go.
That sounds better than Sunday to me. I mean, I can't guarantee that I'm going to be there. That's
no, I know Rebecca is.
I have a hard time.
You're teaching skiing. I mean, I don't know. What time?
It's just driving back on Saturday night.
There's that. And
or really early Sunday
going
morning.
On Monday. I mean, we had a lot of people
too.
That I'll go, and I find it. I find it very helpful, as a matter of fact. When you guys don't send me the site visit notes, I can tell what's going on from the site visit notes. But I don't expect this to go on forever, but I'll take advantage of whatever Mondays you guys have the site visit on.
Well, I know that from my brief experience with site visits, the more people are there, the longer it takes. So. Let's, you know, not loiter. Let's get in and look at what we've got to look at and get the hell out.
I agree with you.
Didn't like that soils lesson that we had over
here?
That was helpful.
That was fine. I had a little bit of time, then I had to go. But, I mean, generally when there's a lot of people there and it's if we make it Monday, Chuck makes it and everybody makes it, maybe except one member. I mean, I don't want to have a four-hour Monday site walk.
I'm stuck on tradition, but to me it rubs the wrong way to have a site visit during work hours
because they won't be home. Most people won't be home.
People won't be home. It restricts commissioners if they work, if they have a non-flexible job, they couldn't be on the commission.
Sounds like it helps this commission.
Yeah. Well, so I think that's a point, though. I think the meeting should be able to be flexible for what works to the active commission members, whether it's now or next year or whenever.
Yeah. I don't think we have to be rigid about it.
Exactly. I think we need to do what makes the most sense now for the upcoming meetings, because if somebody says, well, I'm not joining the commission because I can't do a site walk on Monday at noon. I think there's a
thought to it. They almost talked me out of joining for the interview. They're telling me how much hours I have to put in this board. Oh, dear. How much time do you have? It's a lot of hours on that board. I'm like, geez, what am I signing up for here?
You know, at the same time, there's people on Sunday mornings that are going to, whether it's a religious establishment, that wouldn't want to attend on a Sunday morning as well. So I think there's there's potential for a time to conflict with anybody's schedule that they...
I could do a Sunday afternoon, actually.
How late?
I could get down...
Oh, couldn't do it during Patriots games, though. That would be enough.
Okay.
I say for right now, I propose
there
we stick with Monday.
Kind of out of it. I'm sorry, what?
I was going to propose we stick with Monday. I mean, we do have at least four members saying it's potential.
I think we get three sets of eyes on any site visit, and it's
I think
it's
that's
good
more
for
than
the board.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. More than enough. And I'm sure it's going to change. So I
do we all agree with that? We're
going to
vote
so.
Or just going to agree? Okay. I have another question. What are the meetings for January? We're talking
two
about the...
January 13th.
January 13th is a scheduled meeting.
27th.
But then we were talking about that special one, but we haven't decided when we're going to do that.
We meet the 2nd and the 4th, right?
Well, January...
Yeah.
Yeah, but...
2nd and 4th Wednesday, so that'd be
the
13th and the 27th.
But keep in mind, Al, that if the bids come in for Randall Road from... We might have one earlier in January, just for
like
that one.
First week.
Six.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Hopefully.
Okay, so I'm...
To address that.
I'm away till the 6th. I'm back on the afternoon of the 6th, so I could do something on the 6th, but I wouldn't be able to do anything earlier than that. And then I'm here for the 27th meeting. I mean, I'm not here for the 27th meeting. I'm away on the 22nd. So, and then I'll fix my schedule. I go back and forth to Florida, so that's what I'm only booked in from the 22nd until the 8th, I think. So then I'll set my agenda on this. I didn't have this last time I was booking
the 8th of February? You're going from the 22nd till the 8th of February?
Yeah.
We have a meeting on the 10th of February. So you actually only miss one meeting and two
good.
Site visits.
Good. Okay.
So could you just email me those out?
Yeah, I will. I'm ruining my perfect attendance record.
Nah. All right, meeting minutes.
We'll schedule the violation meeting that
when I'm not here.
When you're not here.
Meeting minutes. Do we have notes on those?
So
no,
I'm
just not that.
You know why the pile of leaves is
that's
so high?
Strong a feeling about it.
You know why the pile of leaves is so high in the back of the houses? Because they can't spread it out because there's water behind it.
Well, you know, I drive around this town all day, every day for a living, and
on the roads,
yeah,
or in the back,
everywhere. And
in
I've been well, no, on the roads,
okay.
But I've been looking since you said this to me, and
come along with me.
I haven't seen anything jump out at me in the last 2 or 3 weeks.
You know why? It's camouflage. It's actually the same color as what's out there.
Yeah.
So when we say it's a green, it's.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like just relocating biomatter that some wise guy told me once. So.
Okay.
The minutes.
Can we adjourn?
No, we've got to do the minutes.
Minutes is the problem.
So
I move we accept the minutes from Wednesday, November 18th.
I've got a few minor comments.
Yeah.
So
thank you.
We
now
have a number for Harvard Street.
Yes.
We should get that in there.
Mm-hmm.
I just had on that same one on Harvard Street, and I gave a markup to it, but I make a move to strike the last couple sentences of the first page there. It's the first page of the minutes. So Norris could take soil samples to clarify the wetland if all the way to the hearing not going to be closed tonight without clarification. You know, this was somewhat of a side, it kind of detracts from what the decision, what the applicant chose to accept the wetland. Either we need to state this a little bit more clear what was going on here, or we just strike the two sentences there about Norris and Sullivan.
Strike them.
So two sentences, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
The two sentences being the hearing cannot be closed tonight.
No. Norse could take some soil samples to clarify the wetland. Mr. Tyrone asked Sullivan Engineering get clarification on delineation.
But that never happened.
Yeah.
They chose to, you know, use the old line.
Right.
And leave it at that.
That's right.
It didn't make sense for them to do that.
Yeah, but it's still, well, he was asked to do that.
Not really.
No.
Not really as it was written here.
Is Coltec, is it C-O-L-T-E-C? Or is it?
C-U-L.
C-U-L.
Yeah.
Coltec.
C-U-L-T-E-C.
I think the rest were just some minor typos, so.
And, oh, yeah, Mr. Flynn, not MF. Manufacturing films. Oh, you got that one too?
Yeah. Can't get my name.
So I had one last question.
Well, wait, there's a motion on the table.
I'll second the motion to approve the minutes as
amended. All those in favor? Okay, Chuck?
This is a question for Julie. Are we getting the final?
I owe you version. A bunch of final versions.
Okay. We need to. I don't. And I'll. Kind of important to keep up with that. I don't know what your system is, but do we have any final ones?
Yeah, but not from probably the summer
okay.
to the present. So, got a bunch to update. But so I have all the information, all the. Edits that everyone's given me.
We have to.
So wait, the minutes from previous meetings haven't been finalized?
No.
So we put up the draft until the final is available. That's how it works, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so the draft meetings are up there, but we're supposed to be swapping them out when we're getting finalized, and I did notice that we didn't have a lot of final minutes. So, you know, I don't know that, you know, we need to catch up, and I don't know if
sure.
there's something we can do
yeah.
to
I'm coming
Gene
in this Friday,
mm-hmm.
so
maybe that'll.
I'm gonna do some of that, and then I think someone's probably gonna want to see this. I think out of the Randall Road,
right.
they're probably gonna be asking.
Right. I actually think one of the ways to help out with this is not to scribble down comments and use your computer and use track changes. And
okay.
then they could work out a lot
just
better.
Just accept changes. Right?
Yeah. It makes so much sense. I mean, I know when I get something and it's written, it's hard. It's hard to even decipher what it says. So,
yeah, but if we have five versions with track changes to try and merge all that, is not a simple task.
Well, I mean, it's no easier than having five different marked up.
Well, I mean, what could happen is we make the changes and you just record them on your copy in front of you as we go through the changes at the meeting. That way everybody gets to hear the changes and we either accept them or not.
We've been doing that and we're behind, so we need to make a change. And if anyone can, that would be great. I mean, of course we got these today. So nothing could happen. But if you have the time and anyone could do track changes, and she'll have one less person. I mean, I assume you're going to do it. But we'll have one less person's comments on it. And, you know, he's pretty active with everything he does. So maybe that's going to be 64% of all the changes you have to make, and it will help. So
okay.
That's.
You know, I've been in a lot of other communities as an applicant at the conservation, and there's been a lot of times where I've requested meeting minutes. There's not a lot of communities that are doing anywhere near what we're doing. I mean, Groveland, they don't even take minutes. There's a recorder that doesn't run half the time, and nobody ever transcribes it. A lot of towns aren't being anywhere near as diligent as we are. I think what we could do is just give them a quick read, and if there's a couple little things wrong with them, just let them go and let them print it in a final draft. I mean, we don't have to be so specific in these minutes, I don't think. Do we?
Well, the final version, that's my fault. I've gotten behind on
minutes in case
yeah.
an issue comes up. It has to be
accuracy. Certainly, it needs to be corrected.
Yeah. You're saying we're putting too much into the minutes? It's too lengthy?
No, I don't think the length is the problem. I think that when she prints these drafts, when we get these drafts, a lot of what I see going on is seems to be fairly minor. And I don't know, striking that sentence, I'm not sure if that's going to save anybody in a lawsuit 10 years down the road or protect us any way. I mean, I don't think it's, if we're looking to streamline, that might be one way to do it.
I don't know
why six people have to comment on the
made
minutes.
It a little clearer.
Just
maybe we do. I don't know. Maybe we do.
Maybe this is
No, I see your point, but I always when and sorry to interrupt.
Go ahead.
But I see your point, but I feel like when people do the minutes, it's really not my forte. But I understand the argument, and I love the fact that people want to get it right. So when I look back on it, it's accurate. When someone asks for something, from years ago, that commission went through it, and they see the changes, and they know that they put time into it, so it must be accurate. So, I mean, I kind of agree with you, but I don't think we should not put the best minutes out we possibly can. So.
Yeah, that's fine. I just... thinking out loud.
Just to follow up with what you're saying, for me, I'd like to see something a little bit happily in between, where the minutes are sufficient to get some of the details summarized. So a good executive summary is what I'm hoping the minutes will be. But as well, we also have the recorded video for this, for all these, for many
we
of these meetings.
We do have a recorded video.
And Bill
Hecht and I got caught in a nasty, nasty situation where we didn't have minutes. So we had to go, we tried to go back through those videos and recreate it. And it was very difficult to access the videos. Some of them were missing. There were gaps in them. We really were not able to do it through the videos.
It's probably different now, though. I would think they're probably more accurate.
Well, even if they are there, the ones we did see trying to go through and take notes from what happened was incredibly difficult. I think that we need to be very careful and precise when we make a decision, make a request, or make a ruling. Whether, we talk about how, whether it was a 20-inch pipe or 18-inch pipe, doesn't matter.
Right.
But when we make a decision or make a request of an applicant, that needs to be accurately recorded.
Oh, I agree.
Which generally is, right? We're doing that.
Yeah, I think so.
Pretty much.
Most of the time.
Okay. How are we doing? Good?
You're doing good.
All right.
Move we adjourn.
Have we approved these minutes?
I think we did.
We did.
We already made a motion.
Yeah, we did.
Okay.
Made a motion to approve as amended, and we voted.
Okay. Mr. Chair, can I just bring up something else?
Yes.
All right, found this in the Advocate in late November. I haven't read it, but, the story of the pipeline working its way through Massachusetts is not going away, and
yeah,
it's
coming.
I still don't know the... there was some chatter on the... notification from Eugene Benson this week, and there was a little bit of discussion back and forth until somebody on that whole link said, please let's not discuss this because it's filling up my inbox. But there was this public notice that was put out, and I'm sure, can I hand it to you, Rebecca? Or, I don't know, there's questions concerning this can be... so it talks about available documents and if you have any questions. Of course, the area where we are is filled with dots and lines and, so I have no idea based on this what's happening in Reading.
Have you gone on and taken a look at some of those maps?
When I was talking to you about it in depth earlier this year.
You can't tell where, they just took shots of a topo.
and unless you knew exactly what this hill was, it's very difficult to follow.
And I know their list of available posted documents are encyclopedic.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It's literally searching for your neck of the woods in a haystack. It's really...
So where's it likely to go here in Reading? Just up that one little corner?
I still don't.
Right,
I still don't know.
Wetland's the best
the
place
latest.
For it to be.
Is it near...
Oh, I'm serious.
What'd you say, Brian?
I actually have never
seen them
anywhere
else. The
best place for it to be? They put it under the ground, they cover it over, and they're done. No?
Yeah, sure.
Like fees we can generate.
Need energy.
So they're saying that there's going to be permitting. This is what they were talking about on that. So we're going to permit that project if it comes through here, and so is the state. So.
And our fees are high in the wetland. They're probably exempt from our local bylaw, though.
Not sure.
I don't know that they would be.
They may not be up there.
They've paid big fees in other towns.
Railroad toll. Is that from state laws?
I've been asked about this a couple of times. I just can't get my head out of the fact that it's just way up that corner of Reading in the swamp, almost in the other town, and there's already something there. And they're just kind of going down the same area. So for us, it's... someone's already did it.
Yeah.
Right. It's, I hate to say it, but if
it's gonna happen.
Be interesting, and there was fees that would be.
It's gonna be a collection of fees, something we pay attention to, but from
It's not cutting through anything that. It's not new land.
I think there's a vernal pool up there, but it may not be close enough. It may just be outside, the. So, but the other thing is, I think there was one of those, was it a pumping station or some sort of station?
Meter pit or something.
Some sort of station that they were going to put on the RMLD property in North Reading, which is near that line and that boundary.
Gas or water?
Gas. Gas. That Tennessee Gas was going to... take over part of this Reading Open Land Trust property that is just in North Reading in that corner. And there was some discussion about, hey, those give off a certain amount of noise on a regular basis and a certain amount of potential vapors. And, I've been skimming, I've just sort of kept half an ear out on all the chatter that's come my way. But I think we need to know about it before it comes before us. Just know a little bit more. So if anybody's willing to take that up.
Sure, I'd love to go through those resource reports.
Nothing worse than reading one is writing one.
I'll see if I can nail down exactly which parts of which reports, because I have found them.
Okay, is that all?
Are we all set? Or?
No bills, no emergency
bills. Nothing else in the, from you,
Joe? No bills yet. We'll be taking the chair over by the year, and we'll have bills at that point. We'll have bills like heating bills and... repair bills and all those things that need to be approved.
Nothing now, though.
Yeah.
Okay. Unless there's anything else?
Happy holidays.
Yeah. Happy holidays. Yes. And
Merry Christmas.
Nice. Close the doors. Get up.
Ho, ho, ho.